by Delta, and for the first time with much pleasure by Zoc. Gentlemen, how are you doing?
I am doing fantastic. I'm super excited for this three-man cast because I've casted both of you individually. And having this time, it's going to be a good time. Aaron, how are you doing over there?
Yeah, this is like the connecting of the two triangles points. I'm excited to see how this goes.
Yeah, it should be a fun one today. Our NYU Lavender are taking on the University of Illinois Fighting Illini.
Yes.
The Illini, I believe, are 11-0.
Right. Wow. 10-0 regular season and have not lost yet, obviously, in the bracket. We are in winner's bracket.
So. For those of you that were not around for last week, the Lavender absolutely routed the Lobos. Aaron, did you catch that one?
I did not, unfortunately, but I heard it was a stomp, and I'm looking forward to seeing some of that prowess brought back again today.
And Aaron, you're friends with some of the guys on Lavender, right?
I am. Yes, I play semi-frequently, not as much as of late because they've been practicing with scrims for this, but with Believe Survivors, the support for Lavender, and he's great. He's all over the map. When you're playing top lane, he'll be up there at level 4 as Alistar, and you're like, what is he doing here? How did he get here? So I'm looking for some of those exciting plays coming out of him.
Well,
just overall to see how it goes. Looks like we're getting into draft, though.
Yeah, we're in draft
already. Thankfully, we have plenty more excitement to start off the draft. Bans coming out from NYU Lavender. Nunu Tristana followed up by Anivia and Seraphine on the red side. Feel like those are some good red side bans.
Yeah, seems to me like all pretty typical stuff. NYU will get the first pick here. Powerful stuff still left up, obviously, but right now you just can't ban everything, so you got to pick your poison.
Boys, what do we expect for the B1 here?
I was actually just going to say.
Yeah, it seems like throughout most of competitive, the meta is first round going for bot side and your jungler. A lot of very strong power picks there. And counter pick is not quite as important as in solo lanes. So the Hecarim is not at all a surprise. And I would also not be surprised to see a jungler from the side of University of Illinois. Kai'Sa, though, is of course up. And that is the best blind AD carry in the game. So, of course, that is going to be locked in for them.
Let's level set real quick. Do we think there's a better ADC in lane than Kai'Sa right now?
In lane? That's viable? Maybe. No. Misfortune gets some play. And I actually think that Misfortune maybe is a little bit better than Kai'Sa in lane. But it's not enough to make it worth it because of how much better Kai'Sa is later. Sejuani's going to be the answer to Hecarim. This is something that's been theorized a lot as a power pick after the XP changes. So we'll see how that one goes.
Well, for longtime players of League of Legends, we can all remember that when the jungle meta gets either weird or gets stale,
you pick Sejuani.
Yeah, you pick Sejuani. You pick Sejuani.
You pick Sejuani. You pick Sejuani starter. Oh, look, there we are.
We're back. Okay. Lavender falling up here with the Galio and then the Rell. We were talking just a moment ago. Zoc, bring us up to speed on Survivor's immense. Perhaps not.
NYU would like to do some sinning, it would appear.
I was just about to start. Going for the Gnar to end out the first phase of picks here. You can't see our cameras right now, so you can't see the absolutely disgusting look that my co-caster
The only thing that could salvage this is if Illinois picks Renekton.
All right,
that's the only way this can go.
So real fast, Aaron, I'm going to shut you down. Go on your Gnar tirade real quick as we see the shed pick up.
See, I don't hate Gnar the way that LS does because, God, does he hate that champion. Mm-hmm. But I do think that the problem is here with blind picking Gnar. We see the shed is, okay, so top lane's just lost. Move on to a different lane. You just don't get to play top lane anymore. And the issue is that, yes, Gnar is going to team fight well, but now you've exposed that that's what you want to be doing, and Illinois is going to have two really powerful opportunities to play around that. Not to mention that they hovered the Rell and are now not going to be able to pick it because they hovered it to UI. Maybe they would have banned it anyway, but they didn't even get the opportunity now to pick it in the second phase because they hovered it, which is honestly just like a fairly big mistake, I think, in draft.
Well, I mean, Rell's also so strong right now as we see the Corki taken up by NYU really quickly.
And I know you love the Galio, Aaron, as well.
So Leona's going to be the fault here, and that will be Silas to end it. Zoc, do you want to talk really briefly about Believe's proclivity to be playing Rell these days?
Yeah, I don't necessarily that he's been specifically. I don't know that he's been playing it. I do know it's one of the best supports in the game, in my practice for Clash. It's kind of the thing that we settled on. And like a lot of pros have been picking it blind, which is why I was a little sussed out by the Galio pick. Because so you do want to be picking Rell though, it's a stronger champion. But I think there might've been a little bit of a miscommunication and wanting to flex the Galio, but then you can't really pick support because you don't super want to have Galio blind. And what they've kind of done here is they've both pinched their own support pool and also shown that this is probably a Galio mid, which opens up to exactly this, which is a Kassadin counter pick. They've got the Vayne Lulu. Lulu is by far Believe's best champion. He loves playing this character, and pairing it with the Vayne, I think, makes a lot of sense, but maybe a little bit of a hiccup that could get punished.
So for reference, Aaron, Raph is essentially Lulu one trick. He is not a master Lulu one trick, but he is a Lulu one trick nonetheless.
Yeah, I mean,
Diamond two.
Thankfully, I'm glad I have something in common with Believe.
Yeah.
And what's actually great here is that last night, Jaden and I were arguing about what we think is better between Karma and Lulu.
Yeah, we actually were just having this debate.
And here we see it. And now that, you know, the phase has ended here, we're going to have some time to talk about the team comps and how they match into each other. But really quickly, Zoc, what are your thoughts about this bot lane matchup?
Yeah, I mean, I like the Karma pick. Riot has been sort of slowly buffing Karma for no reason for the last like 3 or 4 patches. particularly the Q, I believe the last change is it received a lower mana cost and a lower cooldown. So combined with the wave clear that Kai'Sa has, I do like the Vayne. It is kind of traditionally a counter to Kai'Sa because you can find those duels and it does better in the 1v1 and can kind of play side lane. But I think Karma's gonna absolutely enable the University of Illinois team to get the push onto Vayne Lulu, which is kind of rough if you're playing Vayne. Like, you don't really want to be on the back foot as much. I think it's a good pick, but I think the Karma is also very strong.
Yeah, definitely Karma. And, you know, the thing is now these days is that you just want to have something that can build stone. And so obviously you've got that now with the Lulu and the Karma on each side. You also mentioned the Kassadin as a counter pick to the Galio, and people might be like, wait, isn't Galio supposed to be good into, you know, those AP champions? Well, Kassadin's
broken.
Yeah.
They don't tell you about that.
The thing about this right now is, so Kassadin, I think when they released the new items, was so bad for the first, I don't know, all of preseason and like at least 11.1 and 11.2. Like, just come on. And then it just slowly incrementally got better and better until suddenly at some point it turned the corner and now it's like you can't play against it with any champion. It's so brutal. And the issue I think that's going to happen here is that if this game gets past like the 2 maybe 3 item mark, I think the game just kind of ends for NYU. Like, they can't deal with the Kai'Sa. Karma's gonna have just infinite ults available. Shen's Stand Unite is gonna be on such a little cooldown. Kassadin can be anywhere on the map because of his ultimate.
Well, like, I mean, more specifically than he can be.
And they're all purple.
Will be anywhere on the map. And also, them all being purple is a good point.
Yep.
That's some mind game against NYU, I think.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm a little sussed out by how this draft went from NYU, because you're first picking Hecarim, which generally in the way that competitive drafts have been going usually means that you want to go Galio and Kai'Sa, because all three of those champions can jump in off of the Hecarim ulti. And it kind of enables this like really, really intense dive. NYU got the Galio, they didn't get the Kai'Sa though, and then kind of had to pivot away from this hyper aggressive dive strategy into like peeling Vayne, maybe.
They didn't do a great job of enabling.
Exactly. Oh, absolutely. I think it was it's clunky. The other thing that I really like about the Kassadin pick is that the thing that people forget about Sejuani is with melee mid laners, it enables very, very strong 2v2 because you can get that E passive off really quickly. And so I don't know. I don't see how NYU can ever fight 2v2 against the University of Illinois mid lane jungle duo.
Well, for the first time between Lavender as well as Violet, we're looking at a bit of a draft gap. It's been a while.
Yeah, I agree. I do think, though, the one thing I'd like to say in favor of NYU's team comp is that I think they're going to have a window, and if they can get early drag prio with the Hecarim, they're going to have a window in the earlier game before we start to see those items come through for Kassadin and Shen and Kai'Sa, that mid, like early to mid game team fight is going to be significantly stronger. And if they can use that to play around objectives, if they can get a dragon lead, if they can get some pressure onto towers, I think that's going to be their opportunity to get the gold that they need to stay competitive in this game. But they need to be able to utilize that. You need to have, you know, probably just clean 5v5s with Gnar coming down to dragons, like really pressure UI to find gold on other parts of the map. And if they're able to do that, I think they have a shot. But if they're not, then I do worry about the scaling of Illinois.
Well, the other point that I was going to make is, you know, in a certain way, you love Kassadin into handshake lanes, right? It's phenomenal. And essentially, that's what this is, right? These are two mid laners designed to beat up on AP mages. Right?
Sure.
And they both are. So in this weird way, I think specifically at level six for both of them, Galio has a bit of an advantage, right? Can create prio around the map, can maybe make some plays, whereas Kassadin still has to, you know, be kind of tied to farming.
Yes and no, but I do think that Kassadin sort of tie Galio to mid lane.
That's true.
Aaron, I think you were going to say something about it.
Well, yeah, I'm just, because Kassadin, obviously, he gets 15% magic damage reduction from his passive. Galio gets the shield tied in with the W. When you hold that, you get additional magic resist. I don't think that, having played a lot of Galio, I don't really think that you can absorb a ton of damage from Kassadin with that and get a lot of value out of that, unless you're preempting the Rift Walk. But if Kassadin goes electrocute, I don't honestly see a world where Galio is ever winning trades outside of maybe like level three. You know, if that Force Pulse is available, which it will be, because Galio, the way that he's going to have impact in this game is by shoving waves. I wouldn't be surprised if he went Predator, because he's got to get that early impact. The Galio and the Hecarim have to get the ball rolling. Otherwise, Kassadin's going to hit six and like Rift Walk onto Galio, and he can't EOA. He's just going to get like auto attacked down. So I think that's going to be where we're having to look for NYU. I mean, it'll be an experiment to see. I haven't seen Sejuani Hecarim in a long time. I don't know how that matchup goes, and I think that's going to be the story of this game.
Well, so really quickly here, we're going to do something kind of fun, because I now have two colors to do this with. All right, so we're going to start with you, Zoc. You're going to give me your best pitch for why Illini are going to win this game off of draft. And then, Delta, it's going to be your turn to give the pitch for the Lavender. So, okay. Zoc, get us going.
All right.
Sum it up for us.
I think, first of all, Illini has two winning lanes. They have the bot lane and they have the mid lane winning. I think the Sejuani theoretically will do a good job of neutralizing the Hecarim, which is kind of the early to mid game power point for the NYU team. And I think they're just not going to, I think they'll be able to resist the pressure of the Hecarim and the Galio early, and the Kassadin and the Kai'Sa are going to be able to hit two items without that much difficulty.
All right.
Yeah. I think that NYU, though, yes, they have, I think, losing lanes on the bot side, but I do think that the Hecarim is going to be a fast enough clearer. This is funny, because like, I don't know if I actually believe this, but he'll clear fast enough that he'll be able to get like bot scuttle prio and get that Sejuani out of the bot lane enough to get a couple of dragons, and I think then it becomes really hard for the Illini in that bot side.
Well, I mean, what's weird is I buy like half of that.
Yeah, I think I buy about half of that.
Yeah, and the half is that I buy is that Hecarim.
I think I agree with Zoc.
Hecarim will absolutely, you know, just have a faster clear. That's just how it works, right? So, you know, if Max is able to put on a clinic here.
All right, so then fine. So then let's just do it. Let's just clean. We have three, so we don't have any ties. Prediction, go. Hot fish.
Man,
just clean. I mean, don't give any justification. Just pick a team here.
Golden Guardians.
Niles.
All right. I got to give it to the Illini here. Yeah. But that's how it is.
Zoc?
Yeah, I think I agree. I do. I know you said no caveats, but I do want to put on the caveat that I think if Vayne gets to the point where she and Lulu can resist getting one shot by Kassadin, and this bot lane gets ahead for NYU, I think there is very little recourse for Illini.
Yeah.
They don't have a ton of damage outside of Kassadin and Kai'Sa. And if those two champions aren't enough to burst Vayne through the Lulu shielding and wild growth, that's the win con. So
yeah, I mean,
definitely routes.
As somebody who's
just quickly, Steve, someone has correctly pointed out in the chat that we are not in fact playing retro games in the Mystery Tournament number 3, but we are in fact playing League of Legends. So
we are.
If you'd be so kind as to change that title.
Yeah, I mean, the thing that I was going to say is having played a fair bit of Lulu and also having played a fair bit of Lulu Vayne with you.
There is a point where it's
there's a point where it doesn't matter. And what's interesting is that generally when we talk about champions capping on items, right, it's bad, right? When Olaf hits two items, he is now the same champion.
Right.
He will never progress from this point. However, in the case of supports, this can be a boon. As a support, when you reach, you know, your power spike, and that's just it, you don't have to do a whole lot past that.
So just for fun, I'm going to say I think that NYU is going to play the macro game well enough. They're going to get this Dragon Cryo, and they're going to make it happen in such a way that they will, in fact, win this game. So I'm going to disagree with the two of you just for fun on this one. And I do think that the
Thank
way
you,
do it.
Boys, both of you for the pitch on the blue side. You have our very own NYU Lavender on the red side.
The audio on my end, at least, I don't know if it is for my co-casters.
There's a little bit of a lag. For me. Not a lag, but it cut out a little bit. It seems like you guys are a little far away, maybe.
Did you hear that?
Okay.
Oh, it sounds good Aaron, now. It sounds good now.
Aaron, go ahead and take over for a second.
Hold on. All right. Aaron, tell people
what side of the map we're on. So NYU here on the blue side. It looks like we are going to get just a 5-point setup from both teams. A couple of early wards getting dropped out on the top side, which I think generally indicates a bot side. Actually, it's going to be a top side clear for both junglers. So might be a skirmish around that scuttle in the bot lane. We'll have to see. I do believe Hecarim will clear faster, so he will have his pick of the scuttle crabs.
Are we
sorry?
Good?
We can hear you. Yeah, you're back. Welcome back.
We are back with zero Monka S's in the chat. Yeah, so I would say it's a success, personally.
That's the measurement, yeah.
Yeah.
But yeah, I think I heard what you're saying about Hecarim Steve, our wonderful production manager, Steve, could you please change the drag the champions on the list so that they're in the right place?
Yeah, so
a little bit off. Thank you. And yeah, I think this is the thing. One thing we didn't actually talk about though is that early game, Galio just gets to shove in a Kassadin way harder than Kassadin can do anything about.
Yeah,
there will be a little bit of that.
And not only does he get to, he kind of has to, because he knows that in 10 minutes he's not going to be able to do anything against that champion. So he's getting as much pressure as he can out of the advantage he has at the moment. And we'll have to see if they can translate it into anything. Oh, a poke, though.
Believe here big getting absolutely here cool. Level 1, only with Glitter Lance.
Haven't gotten level 2.
No shield yet, no way to apply picks. Just taking a ton of damage on these trades. Boys, a little quick question. What is the default max on Kassadin these days?
E. Okay. No, that's... Q. Yeah, E or Q. Actually, I have seen Q.
I think the high level strat is you do 3 points into Q and then max E.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
Yeah. It's also, I think Q is really good in this matchup too, having it up because you can cancel the taunt channel. You could even, it's actually just a worthless ability because you can just Q and then Riftwalk in on top of Galio and start murdering him.
How Galio, like, sort of just, the only way he gets advantage from that magic is this shield is, like, by predicting the risk walk. But at that point, you're already kind of lost, as we might see a 3v3 down here in the bot lane.
Positioning.
Maybe a 4v3 even with the Galio walking down.
Galio is walking down here, but Anton is low. He's gonna have to flash, and that will just be that. Anton going down, first blood, going over to the Kai'Sa, and immediately any thoughts of an early game skirmish are just gone. Kokoro here and Max a little bit worried. They're just going to have to walk out, tail between their legs. An unfortunate start to the game here.
Yeah, I think a little bit awkward, just the timing communication wasn't quite there about like when the Galio and the Hecarim are going to arrive in the bot lane. So Anton got a little bit excited there and was not able to stay alive for long enough to turn it into any kind of meaningful skirmish.
I'm just wondering why Riot thought they needed to buff Karma this much. I mean, NYU, they've got Lulu, which is by no means a champion that can't push waves, and they're stuck under their tower level 1 because Karma can just spam these inner flames for no reason. So I think the pick is already carrying the bot lane for the University of Illinois team, and we might see this banned in the next game or some kind of adjustment.
This has happened before, though, where, like, I remember it maybe was Season 9 at some point where Riot was like, you know, Karma isn't getting played enough. We're just going to buff her
so
much.
No, it's not just Season 9. It's happened
as...
Well, Hegrim's here. The Hegrim dancing around, but Shen... Yeah. Clay doing his best, you know, Allen Iverson.
Well, he can't auto there.
No.
During the shield. No. The
Spirit's Refuge.
There you go. Thanks.
Keeping him safe.
But yeah, it just doesn't do anything. So good job there from the Shen.
It's
all safe.
I'm surprised Max didn't actually go for that. It would have canceled the damage, certainly. I do believe the CC would have gone through, though. They did end up getting the flash and trading that for the ghost on Hecarim, so it is overall worth it. But I don't know. I feel like they could have gone for a little more there. But certainly good to get that flash out of the way, and we might see a return trip up there as a little bit of vision is being cleared by just chilling in the bot side.
Yeah, I mean, right now, the only thing I think that you're really excited about if you're NYU is that you do have a pretty significant lead in both farm and XP in the jungle.
Huge.
You really need to make that happen. Like, that needs to be impactful. If we do see level 6 is just hit there for the cast it in, so the Riftwalk is now available. Stand United now available as well. A lot of map pressure going to start coming through here for Illinois, and not enough prio. We talked about that early dragons possibly being the key for NYU, and they do not have the prio right now for that.
Sejuani here approaching the mid lane. Thinking about making something happen there. Didn't quite catch. No, there is not any vision in that bush.
Ooh.
Now, moving down towards the bot side of the map.
It's really scary. It's really good Max didn't cancel his recall here, because it looks like they might be going for the dive, but actually the face check might be back for fear of Max here, yeah.
Max there almost seemed like he was AFK. So unfortunate, because he had a 2-level advantage there.
Yeah. The
fact that Kassadin... Or excuse me, Kokoro there channeling a teleport with Kassadin right nearby and gets it canceled by a Q.
Yeah.
That's brutal.
That's brutal. And you just actually just need to know that that's a possibility, I think. But yeah, definitely Max was already thinking about what items he was going to buy, but maybe could have bought some more items with the extra gold he would have had if he was paying attention. So a little bit unfortunate there. Well, I mean, they won't really get punished, but it is definitely sad they had an opportunity. I mean, Hecarim had 2 levels on Sejuani right there.
Yeah. Well, and you know, look, again, you're right. It's not that they're getting punished, but that's now the second time that Max had a serious opportunity to get something done. Kind of squandered it a little bit. But here in the mid lane, maybe trying to make something happen, but Kassadin has Riftwalk, so I don't really know what you can do.
Well, and you notice that Hecarim is actually, he has a Bounty Cinder. He's not going for, he took his early lead, and instead of investing in damage stats, he really wants to get tanky, which signals to me that at this point, NYU have realized that they cannot do anything until Vayne gets 3 items, and they are all in on that game plan now. So if
you
it was
like
about,
that?
I don't think so. I mean, I think.
Yeah, I agree. I'm not a big fan.
Maybe. They don't have any damage to kill Kassadin.
Yeah, Taunt lands into the E, but Kassadin just presses R and walks away. Actually, did have to blow the flash there. No, that's important.
You got a flash on a 4-second cooldown. If I'm Kassadin, I'm not stressed.
Yeah, that's a good point. I don't know why.
There are a few champions that flash on left.
Max here with absolute zero remorse. Stan United comes in, but so does the Galio ultimate. Taunt lands on the 2 players.
Tomorrow.
Picks up the kill on to the Sedge, and that should just be
wow.
2-0 here going to NYU. They need to walk out pretty quickly here, though, because the
Illini
are really collapsing. I think on the other side, though, so close. I think Kassadin is just going to escape here with a sliver of health, and Max has to once again walk away. I don't know if he's going to be able to get out of this. Kai'Sa does have level 6. If she lands anything, she gets the ball off. There is just chilling
here.
That's unfortunate. Dies after picking up a 2-0 advantage with all the jungle camps up.
Yeah. Go ahead.
Well, you can see how much pressure this Kassadin is exerting just by being on the map and by getting minions. I don't hate that NYU went for that play. I think they have to. I think that they're on a clock right now, and they've got to make something happen. They've got to, like, they've got to hit their item points in a way where Hecarim and Galio are going to spike, and then that can carry into the Vayne spike. So it's not all terrible for them. They've got some gold onto the Galio. They've got the Alternator, so he's going to be able to do a lot of burst potentially onto some of the squishier members. But they're going to, they have to keep going.
Oh, no. Belief survivors cleared one ward in that bush, and then they were stacked on top of each other perfectly. Then he walked away while on.
Oh.
Another ward.
Brutal.
The other thing I was going to say, though, is you mentioned, Zach, about how they need to just play around this Vayne getting to item timings. And I was going to mention at the time that I'm worried about that with the Kai'Sa anyway, where they're both three items. I'm not sure that Vayne's actually any stronger. Well, Kai'Sa just got two kills and has a Kraken Slayer already.
With a Lulu, I think so. But again, you just said, two item disadvantage for the Vayne. It's going to take a lot longer to get to that point, for
it's
sure.
Really worrying.
Yeah.
That's not where you want that gold if you are NYU. That is like the worst possible play. Maybe the Kassadin.
Better than Kassadin, I'd say, yeah.
I'd like to point out something we saw a little bit that's new as we see a fight here.
Fight here breaking out in the mid lane, but Max is a little bit caught out over the jungle, though. I think Aura is just going to be leading, just chilling. Kill goes over to the Hecarim, and...
The fear on Hecarim is what I was going to point out. I've seen that actually a few times since 11.5 came out, when they changed Mana Mune to have more of an impact with spells. So it's now much better with Hecarim Q. So it's actually, I think, really good.
Yeah, and I think actually I'm being kind of underwhelmed by the Sejuani pick so far. We knew that it was going to get kind of outpaced by the Hecarim early on in the game. But at this point, it doesn't seem like just Chillin's doing anything at all here.
Go ahead.
No, continue.
I was going to say, getting outpaced and, having gank pressure are completely distinct, right? Sedge should have just had way more gank pressure, and it feels like
Sedge doesn't have either.
I mean, yeah, it just feels like there was, so little,
Gnar TP bot lane as well.
On another time, that's just that. Sejuani down here in the bot lane, putting a lot of damage on the
Koro. Oh, I don't know about that blast cone usage right there, actually. I think that Sejuani's dead if the Koro doesn't save him.
Kassadin here. Kestrel wreaking a bit of havoc inside the bot blue jungle. Just gonna head back towards the
lane. Looks like they're gonna just gonna give that away. I do wanna actually go back to something that Jaden said in Champ Select about the draft from NYU. In relation to that last fight, you mentioned that you wanted them to play around these alt timers for these first and second rotations down from Gnar. And that actually, I think they correctly identified that is also something that they need to do. And we saw that in that last fight, that when that Gnar gets that first rotation down, he actually can have a lot of impact in these team fights with the Galio on top of the Hecarim. So, NYU, they've got all these little points of power where they can make something happen, and so far, they're clinging on to it, so we'll have to see if they can keep going, but there's a fight in the bot lane.
Fine here going really, really low. Stand United is going even lower.
Ooh, really nice
spot. Perfectly timed, but there are four members of the LNI down here, and I think, that will be the Galio going down, throwing the shutdown over to...
I believe it went under the chest. So that's, not the end of the world.
No.
Another shot, there was also equal gold on the shutdown, because you got it. For people to shut down onto the Kai'Sa, actually even in gold, and it's going to be the teleport and the Stand United burn. So I think you could actually argue that for NYU that is worth because of the summoner burn as well. As Hector is here,
fear of Max going in lands a really, really good Unstoppable Onslaught. Two members they are feared. Wakanari is not able to get out. The Sedge does land a stun. Max thinking about going under tower there, but believe a little bit too far back and decides to get it. Up in the top lane, Tramp here putting down a lot of damage, but I think he's just going to push play out of lane, perhaps waiting for range form to come back
so
out.
Low.
Yeah, range form is out here, and that should just be that play doing such a good job zoning here, making it wait for it. There are, we'll end up
getting Galio going back too. In.
Galio is here after picking up the front turn taunt lands. And that's a shutdown.
He's so fast. Tramp. The Galio, the Predator, that taunt is coming at you so quickly.
man, Doc, take it away. Oh my god.
Yeah, I think NYU might have just swung the game there. We saw University of Illinois burning the TP. Well, maybe we'll have to take a pause here as there's a bit of an engage.
Yeah, a little bit of a fight here as Fear Max is caught out slightly, but looks like he's gonna be okay. The dragon is up, but the shed is actually down for a few more seconds, so this is gonna be a 5v4. Not for the actual dragon, but
look at Kaisa. Look at Kaisa on the map. She's split.
Oh yeah.
A little bit caught out here, Fear Max, thinking about going in, but takes so much damage. One Q. Believes survivors, manages to get in front of it, and uses the wild growth. Max in life for just a little bit longer, manages to dodge the Evercross. This turret is not actually any bit of a refuge here. This is getting real dicey here. Shen has almost arrived, but Max is so low here. I don't know if they'll be able to contest this dragon. They are outpositioned by a good deal. I don't know if they'll be able to approach Narc quite a little bit off of the transformation there. They're trying to make their way forward, but that's just going to be that. Not really a contest of any sort there. And the Illinois pick up the dragon.
And it was looking so good for NYU there for a second. University of Illinois actually burned that TP to try and deny the first tower gold from Mystery Tramp, and that failed. So in addition to losing their bot laners to Hecarim, to Fear of Max, they also lost first turret and now have a losing side lane. So I think that they end up getting the dragon in response to that, but in this case, if I'm NYU and I'm worried about getting outpaced in gold, I will take that trade any day of the week. They didn't lose any members, it's only second dragon. First turret gold over to Tramp, and they haven't lost a turret yet. They've lost one. They've lost one.
Actually, up 1,000 gold here.
Yeah, I was just gonna mention, wonderful production man Steve. Can we look at individual gold real fast here, boys?
Okay, so some interesting stuff here. The biggest thing though is that the Kai'Sa, and we talked about the Vayne being so important. The Kai'Sa is up 1,500 gold here in bot lane. But on the other hand, up gold. Gnar's up gold. Hecarim's up a bit. Galio's actually up some gold. Although, Galio has unfortunately not used that gold well, I don't think, as we are going to see a bit of a fight here in the top lane. Mystery Tramp is going to get the stun down. Ooh, actually, there are more members here. And Mystery Tramp is going to get a lot of damage down. The taunt is going to come through the flash for play, but not enough. And Hecarim is here as well. He is very, very dead as Sephora is going to find himself another one. And that is a well-found play.
If you just gank Shen with four people, he's not going to ult onto anyone else, you know? He's being picked on very well, and I think NYU, there's gonna be another fight actually, so take it away, Raph.
Speaking of picks happening here, they're trying to get something done in the mid lane. So well, they might be able to go into turret, but Fear Max stunned up under turret range, ends up taking some Tramp, goes under turret again, but through Lulu shielding and the transform, ends up walking out completely unfit. This is now a 5-on-3 power play on the map for just a moment more here.
Second Rift Barrel's up as well, which I actually think is pretty good here. Yes. You can find it. It's so free.
Yeah, it's absolutely free. They managed to take down mid turret for the low price of nothing right now. NYU, just, you know.
They're just out-rotating.
Yeah, they're just out-rotating, absolutely.
Yeah, I have no idea what University of Illinois is doing here. You see four members on the top side using no ultimates to pick off your Shen for free, and then you engage onto someone else in the mid lane when they have level 11 Galio on the enemy team.
Like
what else are they going to do? What are you expecting to happen? Like they're just going to walk down.
They're like, okay, how long do we have to wait for NYU to beat? That's when we're going to fight.
Yeah.
That was the title. That was definitely a little odd. The one thing I do want to say is I absolutely hate the Night Harvester pickup for Galio here. I think that item right now is terrible. I don't think it's viable. It's just so gold inefficient mathematically. Please just build Rocket Belt on Galio. I'm begging you. Don't build Night Harvester. I don't think that item's very good. But
so I do actually, I generally agree with you. I think 9 times out of 10 Rocket Belt is better, but we talked about how this is kind of a weird game for NYU, right? They need to really focus on this Vayne being their 1v9 carry. And I think that when that is your focus, because late game Galio is not going to be one-shotting anyone on the enemy team. There's no like mage, there's no control mage for him to assassinate. Kai'Sa's going to have her ultimate. She's going to have the Karma shields. Karma's going to be running all over the place. I think that in the context of this game, having the CDR extra from Night Harvester, because it gives, as the mythic passive, extra CDR, will benefit in terms of having more taunts, like we see here, and more ults, and they're gonna try and snowball that.
Go
Zac. And there's, they're already have killed The AD carry, the onslaught of shadows is going to just completely
nullify
as an ultimate. Gnar is going to land onto three, and U of freaking Illinois is just running it down. I don't know why they're doing this.
The 5-0, that Gnar ult was absolutely massive.
We had a caster occasion at the beginning. Sorry about that. The miscommunication we had in the nothing compared to the miscommunication that the LNE had there, and any hope that I think they had of having control in the next couple minutes of the game has been washed into the dust.
So they're losing top tower here, they're going to lose mid tier 2, they're going to lose this Infernal Dragon at the very least. That's the minimum I think that they get away with losing here. So
and a 5k gold lead.
Well, yeah, real quick. You know, on the other hand, 5k. This Galio now is very scary. The Gnar is 5-0. Cassidy is not only he hasn't been bad, he just hasn't participated. Like, he just hasn't actually played the game. So really well done there from NYU, finding some opportunities. That Gnar ult on the four members was absolutely huge. Absolutely here from the Shen.
Absolutely destructive. Both teams doing a really, really good job of repositioning for this dragon here. But I think this Shen is just caught. Not able to get over the wall. Concord takes him down, and now we're in a 5v4.
Gnar ult is up again.
Gnar ult is up to size. Done on one member. That is a dead karma. Now 6-0 on this Gnar. That is a scary prehistoric Yordle, and they are on the dragon. The first Infernal into the pocket, and what? We're sitting at 1,000 gold lead now.
I think we're about 7.
Another 6,000
gold lead here for NYU. And it's all starting to come together item-wise. We can argue about Rocket Belt. The one thing I was going to say, Zach, just for fun, is I actually think if you want that utility, build Everfrost. That's the vibe these days.
Potentially. It doesn't matter.
Yeah, I mean, they're just walking over to Baron here. There's just not a lot that can be done.
Yeah, University of Illinois has played this game the opposite they needed to. You know, people talk a lot about in analysis about how the first two dragons do not matter. There's going to be an attempted steal, but it's not going to go through. It's just going to be more picks for NYU. The first two dragons do not matter in League of Legends, in competitive League of Legends.
Agreed.
And you saw all of the pressure that was bought by your winning bot lane and by your winning jungle mid 2v2 was spent to get the first two dragons, while NYU traded that for essentially gold top, which is the opposite of what University of Illinois should have been doing. The opposite thing. They have the scaling team comp. They're the ones that come third dragon should be wiping because they were getting gold and other objectives while NYU was focusing on dragon. So I think they've completely, I don't think they have any idea how to play around Shen, to be honest. Like, it is, there's been nothing enabled by it.
All Shen has done this game is
we'll just die.
Shen united somewhere, died, and then TP'd back top lane, and then died top lane. That's been the
vibe. That's happened several times here. They're going to try and start a siege here, but quickly, I want to ask you boys something. First, Jaden, can we look at items for just a second here, Steve? How much gold is this Infernal worth?
500, I don't know.
It's about 400 a person at this point. No, it's a little less, about 300.
Well, it depends, because also, the only person who's really stacking, like, stats that work with it is Galio right now. So,
Vayne
building attack speed.
Well,
but she doesn't have that much attack damage.
They may be stacking stats, but currently there will be super minions stacking on the mid lane. This is serious, serious, dire situation here for the University of Illinois.
Well, with Kassadin and Kai'Sa now both so desperate for item, there just isn't enough gold to go around. And Spirit Max is going to go in, and he's going to get a good engage. Galio ult will come through, but will not yield anything just yet.
Perhaps a bit of a misfire there, but not really the end of the world. Tramp here under a lot of pressure.
What's Kassadin supposed to do? He's just dead.
Yeah, Kassadin's only... Max here, Wild Growth has so much health.
Doesn't matter.
He's so stunned up. It doesn't matter. He's not taking any damage. Somehow, Max takes down the first kill onto the karma.
Another
coming out onto three members, and that is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 down. And the Lavender are waltzing into the base in an upset from Draft. They will take game one in this
player diff. Can I get a player diff in the chat?
Yeah, remember when I said that if they couldn't one-shot Vayne, they were going to lose the game, but it wasn't probably not going to work out that way? Well, it worked out that way, and NYU's walking away with game one.
They also didn't kill Gnar the entire... That Gnar was a terror. Like, if I need a player of the game, I'm just going to give it right now. Gnar, done.
It's over. Move on. Yeah, it's over.
Right there.
Over.
Oh, my gosh.
It is over. Yeah, this is that's what we refer to. That's what we refer to in League of Legends as a top gap. Welcome back after that game. That was a rout. I think that the consensus among all of us at the end of pick ban was that was scary. I don't know if we had the exact numbers on hand, but if I remember correctly, Illinois hasn't lost that many games, let alone matches. I kind of recall
this,
that.
It's possible. I think that if I remember correctly, this might be the first game, not even match, but the first game that they've lost this year.
Yeah. So, this is a...
And I'll be honest, after all that early game shenanigans, it didn't look particularly close.
No, and I want to return particularly to something that Zoc said. You know, when you are the scaling team composition, if you see an engage from the enemy team that you don't like, you walk away and someone else goes and gets the gold that's available.
Yeah.
Right? Not the other way around.
Right.
Just because you have an advantage bot lane doesn't mean you can just, Omega Force. This Sejuani was virtually AFK. Yeah,
and Zoc, you made that point too. And so what do you think for your, you were on the side of why does Illinois have the advantage here when we were doing our debate. So what do you think went wrong?
I think if I had to point out to a specific play, the TP top from Shen after the lost skirmish in the bot lane, yeah, where they attempted to save the first turret gold and then didn't do that.
And then he died.
I think that up until that point, they were doing a good job of managing their tempo, managing their resources, and that play just gave away. It was like a train screeching to a halt, and any momentum they had going in to that part of the game had just been completely lost from that point. I think they overestimated their advantage, especially in the top in the side lane, and I think it bit them in the ass. So
a real quick question here. I agree with you that from that moment forward, it was just kind of this train wreck, right? It was moment after moment after moment. But do you agree that, after that Shen play, the game isn't over? Would you agree with that? That it's definitely still, it's definitely still a real game.
Yeah,
but
of course. Panic.
I think of course, but they panicked about it.
Yeah. Yeah, there was an overcommitment certainly, and they'll have to clean that up in game two, because the Shen was just so punished by NYU, and it looked, not only was it punished, because Shen is punished sometimes, like that's how the champion works. Not only was it punished, it looked like University of Illinois didn't know what to do about it. And so if they're gonna play that strategy again, I want to see them adjust and have a reaction to NYU's movements, especially if they can anticipate them. But we'll have to see what route they go down.
Well, I would stress what you said. They didn't know what to do about it in reference to the top lane. I would say, I don't know what they it didn't seem like they knew what to do with Shen.
Yeah.
He knew what to do with Shen as a player, and it didn't seem like the team knew what to do with Shen. Like,
I think he got one or two ults off that game.
Every time I see Shen ult somewhere, not get anything done, and TP immediately back to lane, I'm like, all right, so like, why did you pick this character?
Yep.
Like, what's the point? Yep. Like, imagine if he was playing Gangplank, and he just presses R bot lane and keeps farming. And then all of a sudden, Gragas, sure, this is a very different game, I think. So NYU is actually going to be on the blue side again, as we're going to just hop right back into it. We're no rest for the wicked.
Yeah, we're getting absolute mirror bans here again from the Illini.
Same bans.
These are textbook red signs. I mean, I'm actually of the opinion.
I think it'd be really
there it is.
Same draft. Okay. I think it'd be funny if they chose to get draft gap together because they just know that they could win.
I mean,
now.
I think you're supposed. Okay, I actually disagree with this. I think that the LNE are supposed to ban Kai'Sa here, given that they didn't. I think NYU is supposed to ban Kai'Sa. What do you guys think about that?
Yeah, I think that makes sense. I also don't hate the Galio ban, especially because that enables the Hecarim.
Oh boy!
But the Olaf signals that they want to go for 2v2. So
I don't love that pick. I think Olaf into Hecarim is a
you don't think so? Well, so here's it looked like last game, University of Illinois was really, really interested in getting the first two dragons. If you want to get the first two dragons, Olaf is the best champion to do that. So, you know, maybe it's a, maybe it's kind of a fallback onto more of a comfort pick. It might, again, it can contest Hecarim in terms of clear, and kind of wins 2v2, but yeah, I mean, it's a different strategy.
That's the thing though, is when you talk about like, oh, you know, they're trying to do, the thing is that Hecarim doesn't have to, right? Like Olaf needs to start looking for ways to force the 2v2, and Hecarim can just go, okay, I'm just going to go farm. And at 20 minutes, you're no longer a champion and I am. And we are going to see Gnar, and yes, it's a sin pick, but God, did he look good on it. So
yeah,
he's allowed to sin for
now. It was
now.
An absolute top gap last
here's
game.
Here's the Rell.
I mean, remember last draft, they hovered the Rell, they didn't pick it, and then they really could have regretted it because, I mean, actually, I think if they were allowed to pick Rell B3 last time, we would have gone into draft thing. In their favor.
Well, it wouldn't have been Bane either.
Yeah, it wouldn't have been. So, Believe gets to play Rell. Last week we saw him on Rell, and it was a joke. By the way, I don't know if anybody noticed, Believe didn't die.
No? Yeah, Believe didn't die, and
he's very
also,
good.
Mystery Tramp didn't die.
Yeah, Tramp didn't die either. All right, so we're headed into the second round of bans here. We're going to have the same bot lane for the Illini and for the Lavender, we're going to have the same top and jungle.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think NYU is happy about the way that this draft is going. They get their hands on the Rell. They get to kind of commit to this go-in play style, which they're not really worried about getting countered because University of Illinois has already shown Olaf Kaisa, who are not very good at kiting back, which is kind of how you would counter that traditionally in a traditional
draft. I think they're absurdly bad at it.
Yeah, here's a take.
Oh, why absolutely, yeah.
Yeah.
Olaf can't do it at all.
Let him pick the Shen. Like, yeah. No disrespect, but like slight amount of respect. He should just let him play the Shen because you're not scared of it.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is the NYU stream.
Yeah, we're biased and we don't pretend not to be.
This is explicit bias. All right, finishing off the bans here with the Xayah and the Sylas. Sylas banned last time, the second round of bans as well. I guess that may be Pocket, perhaps.
All right, I want AD Assassin mid lane from NYU.
Oh.
I'm not joking. This is not a meme. I'm not memeing right now. I want AD Assassin and I want a Mage Aim Carry.
Well, they shouldn't do it now because they're blinding Malphite.
Now it's bad.
Okay, now it's bad.
Ooh, I like this actually. I think Ezreal is really good here.
With Rell?
Yeah.
Hmm.
Yeah, this is actually something that I see a lot.
This is the Korean
thing.
This is
a strategy that I know that Jason, that Believe Survivors particularly loves going for, is you pick Ezreal. I've actually participated in this. I've played Ezreal with him bot lane, and I'm laning by myself all the time. I don't get a support anymore.
But that's
But it's okay because Rell's going to be top lane level 4 and is going
to. And you just get to farm with Q, and like you're okay with that, right? Like
yeah, absolutely. Right,
so bird time.
So real quick, I'm going to frame. With the exception of the Hecarim, right?
Production is saying "oh" in my ear. Okay,
we're good.
With the exception of the Hecarim, the Lavender have picked the most absurd disengage comp that exists, and they are playing against Kai'Sa, Malphite, Olaf, and Ekko.
What is this Ekko pick here? I don't know. What do you think about this, Aaron? I think the Ekko pick here, into what Raph was just saying, is just like. You're just shooting yourself in the foot still.
I don't hate it. I think if University of Illinois thinks that they can only play aggressive dive team comps, then that's what they want to do. They've already picked Olaf, Kai'Sa, Malphite. Like, there's no pivoting away from this. It's also, in some mid lane circles, thought of to be a counter to Azir. I know Jizuke picks it into Azir a good amount. So, I mean, at this point, they had to commit to whatever style they wanted to do. It also is good on the side lane. I'm thinking about Orianna. I don't know. I don't think Orianna's there. Maybe,
so,
but like,
real quick,
who are you going to
hit
Shockwave on? You're going to be out of range if you're Ezreal as the other.
That's true. Real quick, I'd love to keep talking about draft, but I'd love to keep talking about it with the coach of the Lavender.
Oh, yeah.
I'd love to do that, but apparently we're not going to.
Your dreams will be crushed.
Do you want to go? And so I believe Aaron and I are going to talk for a little bit. Our co-caster is going to stay in the bathroom.
That's a no.
We're gonna see the draft again. I think it's funny though that NYU is just banning all the A champions.
Oh, there we go. Yeah.
I feel like if they're gonna
banning
do this,
my Ari, man, yeah. Come on. Yeah.
What's the band? Nunu, Yorick,
not
Udyr. No, I'm trying to spell NYU. I'm trying to spell NYU.
There you go.
Yeah.
I do want to say, actually,
yeah, go ahead.
Going back to the Echo, I actually think it's good for another reason. I think that the way that you can kind of... Ezreal is bot lane, and theoretically, yes, he's going to play weak side, and he's going to be able to be very safe. He's got the flash and a 5-second cooldown. He's got the long range. He is playing into Karma Kai'Sa, though, which has very, very strong push. So I do think he will actually get out pushed. And the way that you kind of take advantage of that is by trying to go for a dive, which Echo is very good at and Olaf is very good at. So if NYU does try to go for a bunch of cross-map roam plays with the Rell, I actually don't think it'll be that hard for University of Illinois to just tower dive Ezreal
and I agree.
Get whatever they want on the bot side. We'll see
especially once Olaf has Ragnarok.
Yeah. That is, I do also want to say, though, that is kind of their only option for how to go about this. So there's a potential then for NYU to recognize that and then like preempt that with a counterplay.
How many levels do we have here? Right.
Right. It's going to be some 4D chess, I think, to see where the Rell is and then where is the two-man squad of Olaf Echo going to look. Because they want to kill people because they need to kill people or they're not going to be useful champions.
I do think that there's some potential if they try to tower dive bot, like they start looking for these plays and NYU can recognize that is you've got the Rell roaming around, but you could have these plays where Azir can push so effectively with the soldiers. He moves down towards the Ezreal and you end up with this Shurima shuffle under turret, which as we know results in some of the greatest outplays in League of Legends history.
It's true.
It's the under tower Azir ults. So I think there's some counter roam potential.
But at the same time, and the more I think about it, I think the less I like this Ezreal play because you're picking it into Malphite. So unsure quite who's going to kill Malphite on the enemy team. Then they pick Azir to kill Malphite and to kill Olaf and to hit the front line. But the thing about that is that Olaf can run through Azir wall. It's very hard to deal with Olaf as Azir without using your cooldowns defensively, which of course lowers your damage quite a bit. Combined with the Karma shielding and move speed, I don't know if the carry duo from NYU is going to be as impactful as they want to be. Now, granted,
just from a damage output perspective,
yeah, just from the way that the team fights should work, Olaf should be able to run down both of these. Certainly Azir, and I don't know that Ezreal with the build going on right now, which is Essence Reaver Duskblade, it's a lot of lethality. It's, things that you can itemize against. I think it might be hard for them to deal with the Malphite Olaf duo sped up by the Karma Shields. Granted, that's what we said last game, and then Hecarim and Gnar killed everyone. So
sure.
I think it's a little harder for them to do that this game, but I actually, the more I'm thinking about it, I think I like the draft better from University of Illinois.
Really? Interesting. I don't know. I think this one's a lot closer. I wouldn't say that this is as clean of a draft gap as it was last game. I think I could agree with you on the Ezreal. The problem is, what else is there? Jinx, maybe? It still has the problem of Olaf and Malphite running you down, but if you're worried about that on any AD carry, maybe you're just wanting to be able to do more damage before you die. I don't know. I feel like the MF and Zaya bans here are actually really well thought out from the side of Illinois. I think those are very good because those are the Zaya seems great if you can pick that one here.
Well, and this is what we were going back to towards the start of the draft where you were I believe it was Raph that mentioned that I think the correct play here is to first pick Kai'Sa. And
yeah, I agree.
I actually think this is where this is demonstrating that is the case because when you're picking Hecarim, you're kind of narrowing the style of play that you can commit to. You've got to pick things like Galio, you've got to pick things like Gnar, things that can go in with Hecarim. And it's not that Ezreal and Azir are necessarily bad here, so I'll renege on that. I think they're the right champions for the situation. I think NYU has to pick those champions for the situation. It's just that they're going to not have that. They're not going to have the support that they might normally have if you go for a Kai'Sa first pick, which is a champion that is a little more flexible.
Yeah, I definitely agree that They sort of boxed themselves in with the way this draft went.
But it worked out last game.
In previous patches, you'd like maybe pick even like something like the Samira here. But you can't pick that anymore. That champion's just not playable right now. So I don't know. I think that there's definitely... I think you're right that they definitely sort of boxed themselves in, which is a little unfortunate. But I also think that Ezreal might be able to play enough of like this poke, stand back far enough thing that if Gnar and Hecarim are able to do what they did last game, that they're going to have some options in these teamfights. Definitely the teamfight again from NYU is stronger, I think. And we will see if what happens with the dragons, because, you know, you mentioned, well, if you want to get the first two dragons, why not pick a jungler that's really good at doing that? And they do that in the Olaf. So we'll be interesting to see where the priority lies. Wouldn't mind seeing Rell go top lane, just, you know, both for fun, but also because I think it actually might be the right place to put some of the pressure.
Yeah, I mean, Malphite is, again, another champion that's pretty abusable in lane. You've got the Rell. You could maybe go for a dive.
It's so rough in Gnar, too. Like, I don't feel like that's a great, like... You're kind of agreeing to lose lane when you pick the Malphite here. And I don't think it's the wrong pick just because of how much pressure it gives you later with the ultimate. But in lane, mini Gnar just runs you down. Like, it's really rough.
Yeah. Yeah, this game is going to be, I think, towards the end of it, Olaf versus Azir. I think whichever one of those champions gets to the point first where they can kill the other one while surviving, that's going to be kind of the pivotal fulcrum along which this game is going to tilt. Olaf, of course, though, always worth remembering that you can't really do that passively. Azir will always be able to farm lanes and scale up. For Olaf to reach that state where he's going to be able to run down Azir and hit him with his axe a bunch of times, he does have to get rolling a little bit off of some mistakes from NYU. So,
and I think that's the one thing is that while Ezreal might fight, it's also... Unless they're able to find some of these dives against a lonely Ezreal, it's going to be hard to find pressure for kills anywhere on the map. Like, ganking Gnar is hard, ganking Azir is hard, ganking Ezreal is hard. Like, you need to be able to find these plays in a way that's going to be challenging to set up. Like, they need to find the setup here if you're Illinois.
Yeah, absolutely.
Sure.
We got a graphic for you all. Cool.
So, folks,
hop back. Uh-oh.
I am here back. Here
I haven't seen this yet.
Oh, boy.
Ooh,
this. Nice. Lovely. Hello, folks. I am back. In between games, I have to rest my voice. Being play-by-play is bad for your vocal cords.
Blessing and a curse.
Yeah, honestly. All right.
That is definitely not the mystery band.
No. It's...
Wait, is Mystery Van the coach for both?
No, he's not.
Okay, hold on.
That's actually the right photo, but the wrong name.
Can we see the graphic?
It's on stream. Anyway.
It's on stream.
Steve is our production guy.
So really quickly, that is the person who has won somebody else.
Yeah.
All right, in chat, does anybody know who that is? So that is the person with the most world.
Who was?
All right, once again, on the red side, we have the University of Illinois Fighting Illini. On the blue side, your NYU Lavender.
Oh, yeah, the NYU Illini versus the NYU Lavender.
I said University of Illinois. Yeah, I did. Doc, hang on here. I said University.
Okay. I'm not getting involved in this. I'm not getting in the middle here.
Yeah, the marital spat happening on this side of the camera.
Yeah.
All right, well, folks, see if you can, if you know who's won more worlds. Not a player.
Ah, yes.
Is it not?
Who's he coaching now?
I don't.
Is it not Koma?
It's Koma.
Yeah, it is.
Oh, it's Koma. Okay.
Yeah. 3 SKT.
Yeah. Oh, that's our coach. Yeah. That's why we're so good.
Yep. 3 SKT titles plus the Samsung title. Yeah. 4 titles in a row, by the way.
CSL title on the way.
CSL title on the way.
Yeah.
He's done a lot of winning.
And, you know, sometimes I think it can be easy to overlook the importance of a coach.
At Violet with Mystery Van. Like, unironically, the ability that the things that Violet was allowed to do this year because of the draft gap every game with Mystery Van. And I know he's in chat, so what's up? But anyway, we are going to see an invade here from the Olaf. But Hecarim doesn't care because he's topside.
Yep, and they just get to do vertical jungling. I think all will be well. I mean, I think this even... favor.
Well, this is nice because Hecarim can start to look towards the boss side. If they jungle vertically like this, then Olaf is forced to look top first, which is, I think, the last place he wants to look.
Yeah.
Well, or he'll go for a dive earlier on.
Sure.
All right, well, speaking of early on here, second game, guys on a real low Lee here. It's so much trading so early into the game. Steve, players in the wrong place again, man.
Believe is
not sorry, that sounded so
that
mean.
Was that was very God damn it, Steve.
I appreciate you, Steve, just so you know.
We love Steve around here. He is the reason. I'd like to shout him out just because he is the reason things that happen around here. We would not be casting if Steve did not make it.
I mean, that's not just a compliment.
Literally, we would not be casting. Literally. I actually wouldn't exist if Steve didn't exist.
Yeah, that's true, actually. Yeah.
I'm a figment of Steve's imagination.
Yeah.
So, I do want to highlight what's going on here in the bot lane, because we mentioned that Olaf is going to be
fine. Playing. We'll talk about the game.
Well, I like League. Okay, I love talking about League. We can talk about.
Yeah,
Steve
no. Let, okay, okay,
let's
get
back. Let's get back to the game here. What we saw down there was Olaf looking at potentially doing a dive bot lane, which is, I do actually like it out of the University of Illinois because they want to set this up early with the Olaf and get this bot lane rolling. I would be curious to see if he goes for another attempt at that after clearing his bot side. He's going to have that skull available. It looks like maybe no. If that was the case, they would need to be setting up the wave at this point, but it looks like an engage from Believe here.
He is not afraid of anything.
Yeah, not very afraid.
Although maybe
at
he
all.
Should
yeah.
be afraid of those missiles.
When Rell jumps off the horse, she... I mean, she's like basically rude, isn't it?
It's so bad. You have actually negative movement speed.
Well, she's got pants on.
Metal
pants.
Here we go. It's happening.
What I wonder is how long Anton will be allowed to live here. The answer is previous fight, but Believe here lasting a little bit longer. Kuro does manage to do the damage, but the Echo is on time. Sylvan here doing a lot of damage. Parallel conversion, putting in good damage. Kuro is still so low. The Flash will not end up connecting. Fear Max is in arrives in perfect time, picks up himself a double kill. And that is all in all, what, a 3-for-2?
That's a 3-for-3.
Oh, 3-for-3.
A little bit of a messy one. Go ahead, Sock.
Oh, I was so ready to criticize NYU there for both teams there knew what was going to happen. They both knew that dive was coming. And at the start of it, it looked like NYU was just outpaced and outroamed by the Echo. He got to conserve his TP and they forced it out of his ear. But then Fear of Max coming in at the end and picking up a double while, and I think this is important, none of that gold went onto the Olaf. It was one kill onto Echo, one kill onto Kai'Sa, and one kill onto Karma. So, in terms of how these junglers are going to get paced out, I actually think this is really good for NYU.
I give that a solid grade of it could have been worse, for sure. It's Olaf,
which is what you want.
Survivors jumping out, does have to put the pants on. He is very slow, and he's taking a lot of damage here. It does flash away at the last second, and is barely going to survive that last axe as Ansom taking some damage.
The axe hit out of it.
That axe probably does kill.
We'd have to see a replay, which we don't have.
Sorry.
I'm not acknowledging that. We'd have to see a replay, which we don't have. But I think, I'm sure a lot of people know this, right? The way that Olaf axe works is that it doesn't have to go the full distance.
I think he did.
So the
one thing that Illinois gets is they actually get to conserve a TP, but at the end of the day, I agree with you, Zoc, that NYU is pretty happy with how that went, all things considering, and it's not going to be the end of the world. We do see NAR has a 20 CS lead up in the top lane against Malphite. I mentioned how rough this is for the Malphite, especially early. Here comes Mystery Tramp. They don't want to give up this dragon. They're going to need to. They're just going to push him right off of it. Thanks for the leech. We will go back to our lanes, and that is first dragon going the way of NYU, which should never happen.
And that is just beautiful setup from NYU there. They somehow were able to get this bot lane pushing into the Karma. You saw Mystery Tramp TPing in with a perfect amount of Narbar, and instantly University of Illinois realizes that they can't do anything, and they're going to die. Olaf doesn't even have, level six yet. And this is like best case scenario for how first dragon goes for NYU.
Real quick, Steve. Yeah. After all that, Mystery Tramp misses one minion. As we are going to see a stun come through, Korra might be in a little bit of trouble here. The Olaf is here. He does have the flash available.
Oh, no.
Oh my god.
Oh, Kokoro.
He was out of mana.
Olaf,
he couldn't help. He was out of mana.
Yeah, I was watching that, and he has no mana. He's dodging around the parallel conversions there. Unbelievable.
Kokoro.
The amount of things that have just gone right for NYU in about the past minute is absurd.
Yeah, they've got this razor's edge, but it's been the right side of the razor's edge.
For NYU or gone wrong for University of Illinois.
Yeah, good point.
Well, I mean, when we were talking about what happened, you know, Zoc, you started with, you know, they managed to get the lane pushing into Karma, and then you continue to the next thing. And I'm just sitting here like,
how? How did they do that?
That enough. Yeah. That is a surprise. And then, you know, timing Narbar perfectly, timing it so that, you know, Malphite doesn't just get
it
to
all in.
It
seems like Illinois just weren't expecting a contest at all and got a little bit complacent with their setup.
Yeah, okay. It's a lack of respect towards the bot lane when you think you can just start Dragon with level 5 Olaf and no bot prio. In solo queue, maybe that works because Olaf can duel the enemy jungler, but, like, in competitive play, we'll get to this. There's a fight happening here. Take us away.
Double TPs too.
Believe here goes real deep. Unstoppable Force misses. So that's Unstoppable Force 2 TPs for a kill?
That Believe would have instant into that anyway without the TPs.
I didn't want to say it too early in the broadcast, but this is the flip side of playing with Believe Survivors. Is sometimes he goes a little too deep here. I've been in several games where there's been a kind of, he's dead now, like we just had there.
So real quick here, right? You know, they got a plate and a kill downstairs.
They're going to lose the same number of plates top today.
No, they're going to lose
two plates
top. Yeah, they actually lose gold here.
Which is worth a kill gold, by the way.
Yeah, so they lose two plates, plus the fact that Malphite lost a wave top lane.
Both double TP. Believe was determined to in anyway, so it didn't end up mattering that you use the TPs. And yeah, I mean, this is now already, they have a little bit of extra gold, but with the dragon, it's about even for NYU. And this isn't how this should go. Like, it shouldn't be even right now, not with Olaf. Like, this is definitely a little scary. It's definitely like, we're nowhere near this being over for Illinois, but definitely not the start they were hoping for in the second game.
Well, I mean, you know, the thing about Olaf and Hegrim, right, is that, you know, that Olaf is very ahead at one item, right? And he's ahead at two, kind of, and after that, off a cliff.
I agree.
So they're running out of time here. Ooh, up in top lane. Gnar into Gnar ultimate, though, unfortunately, transforms into Gnar. God, the fact that his ultimate is the same name, I can't. We're calling it
okay,
Gnar.
So here's first tower, and it's going to be solo first tower here, I believe, for Mystery Tramp.
Oh my god, he's so ahead.
Yep. And I want to highlight something that I've noticed in these last two games is that Mystery Tramp on the Gnar has been able to abuse this range. He's kept he's kept the enemy top laner underneath his tower pretty much all of both games, just farming the grass procs. And there's been no punish from the enemy jungler. Like, if this was my solo queue game, I would have gotten punished harder. And there's such a tunnel on the bot side of the map around these dragons that I think maybe merits reassessing from the side of University of Illinois. Because this Gnar they're letting him do whatever he wants and getting away with it.
And so Kai'Sa does have a big farm lead, but Believe, here comes everything. Gnar is here. Mystery Tramp is looking for an engagement, does not have the Mega Gnar, but Kokoro is here as well. The ultimate comes through with the shield. We'll take down Li Guangfang and Wakamari is dead as well. That is two kills for NYU. It is all going wrong for Illinois, and they might have to reassess their bot lane in the loser's bracket, because this is looking pretty good if you're NYU.
Headed straight over to Dragon here. Things have gone from worse to worser.
Agreed.
For Illinois
and Sock, break that down for us.
Yeah.
Well, it just seems like NYU is one step ahead of University of Illinois for every play that they're trying to do here. This is kind of what we saw in the last game, right? When things started to go wrong for University of Illinois, they kept going for these plays that without doing the proper setup to make sure that NYU couldn't respond. And they're just putting themselves in these situations. And like I said earlier, it's a matter of respect. And they're not respecting NYU's ability to retaliate for these plays. They're 1,000 gold and 2 dragons down. Azir scaling. Oh, Kai'Sa is dead. It's all going out the window. It's all going out the window.
Jax here with the absolutely textbook R into E there. And Kai'Sa is looking at a gray screen here. She may be up 39 gold, but she's down. She spent a little more time dead.
Yeah.
Here's the thing. You're putting heavy priority on Kai'Sa Karma, right?
Yeah.
Like, you know, such high prio bot lane. And then you're losing the first 2 dragons? What's going on?
And also,
what is the point?
Yeah, I agree.
I want to kind of go against that because there is a 30 CS lead. There's been a pretty significant CS lead for the University of Illinois bot lane this whole time. It's just the way that they've been approaching the setup with their mid lane and having the top laners rotate that they haven't been able to make use of the fact that their Kai'Sa is 40 CS up and they've just been late to the plate every fight. Yeah. And I think that's the more glaring error here for me.
Well, and of course, I mean, the thing is for me though, is like, of course, much CS. Like, this is the expectation with this weak side Ezreal, but you need to be able to translate it. And they're not finding ways, as we might see.
It's also not weak.
Oh, they're trying to put a bit of
it in. Oh, my
God. Ragnarok is blown early. Actually, somehow doesn't get last count?
Yeah.
It's from the Ragnarok.
Oh, sure.
Oh, my God.
Oh, Kokoro here. He's looking. To get shut down, Bleach Drivers is dead as well. Mystery Tramp finds the ultimate onto 2, but it is not going to be quite enough as on the other side, Fear Max is going to go on a rampage.
Max going pretty deep and manages to answer back 1 kill. Ends up being a 2-for-1 there, a little bit awkward. Split fight. You can see Kokoro there really looking for the shuffle, but
got blown up.
Yeah, he just got absolutely deleted.
So this is exactly what University of Illinois want to be looking for. It's like I said earlier, it's all about blowing up the Azir. They've got the Malphite. This is why they picked this champion, because without the Azir, there just isn't as much damage on the side of NYU. They overextend and they're punished by it. Will University of Illinois be able to find any more of these kind of weird stringed out fights? I don't know, but if they do, this is the blueprint for how they need to go about it.
Yeah, I agree, and it is a little bit unfortunate that they weren't really able to get anything that fight, even though they won it, just because there wasn't much on the map. So they are up about 1,000 gold, but that's actually just completely negated mathematically by those 2 dragons for NYU. So this game's very, very even. And as the Azir and the Ezreal start to get some more items here, Ezreal actually doesn't have an item yet, which is a little bit unfortunate if you're on some. He just doesn't have very much gold right now, but I don't think that the difference, we talked about the Kai'Sa and we're talking about the Ezreal thing is, yeah, Kai'Sa's up, what, 2,400 gold right now on the Ezreal, but I don't think that alone is going to be enough of a solution here for the Illini, unless that continues to grow. Just this gold lead where it's all on the Kai'Sa right here, they're having so much difficulty already dealing with the Hecarim. The Azir is 3, you know, has 3 kills, has that Leandre's Anguish already, and they need to find some other ways to stretch out this gold lead and to find some more pressure, or otherwise it's just going to continue to be hard.
And the Echo manages to land the parallel convergence there, but not a lot of proc the passive. Koro a little bit lower than I think you'd like to be, but the thing that I wanted to add is, sure, Kai'Sa is, you know, up a lot of gold, but what is her plan for being in a fight?
Like, yeah, Kai'Sa does have some short.
She's gonna hold on to his ear.
Yeah, but is that enough? Do you think?
Yeah, and then she gets shuffled, or then she gets relled, or then she gets feared, and then she gets knocked. I mean, what's the plan here?
Well, and I think this is kind of the problem with the draft from University of Illinois is they've got one plan, and it's that Malphite ults onto the backline, and everyone follows him. And
if you have enough damage,
so we're gonna see if they can pull it off again because. So far, NYU has been winning these fights. The Herald is smited away by the side of Illinois, but it is Kai'Sa ulting into the back line, able to find the flash out, and it is actually a 0-for-0, no deaths, but Rift Herald secured there by the side of Illinois as it's going to be the Malphite flashing in, finding the unstoppable charge onto Hecarim. And believe Survivors is taken very low as Lee Gun Young is going to take one down.
Oh, there's the ult.
Used, it was not used earlier, my bad, and a double kill for the Kai'Sa, and that is what Kai'Sa is going to be doing in these fights. These champions all want to go forward, and like I was going to say before that fight started, if they have enough damage to kill everyone, they'll win. If they don't, they'll lose, and in that fight, they had enough damage.
Yeah, I think this is what you were speaking to about. Illinois is going to be better in these extended fights. If they can extend these fights out and just let the Kai'Sa press Q a bunch, it's going to be better. And we're actually going to see another engage. This does not have Mega, though. And is this going to get blown up?
Jeez, as so much damage. Yeah. Trying to go in there, gets, puts on the pants, but now very, very slow. Oh! Ants on here, a micropixel away from taking down Wakanari. Loud to live.
Sag.
True Shot Barrage is not up. Yeah, that's a bit of a sag. I'm not going to lie.
That is very unfortunate. So does not, unfortunately, have the barrage. But yeah, I mean, this is what you said, just to say, reiterate, is when this is an extended skirmish, I do think that Illinois has the advantage, and we saw it there. They were able to draw it out. They did have the damage to kill people, and it ended up working in their favor. They're able to pick up a dragon. They are now up about 4,000 gold. So Illinois finding another a good recovery from what was looking like a game that might have been slipping away from them. And it's gotten back to be very competitive, and actually Illinois might even be a little bit ahead here.
Yeah, and it's off the back of this Kai'Sa that they've really been able to make these things happen. And we can see now, 4,000 gold up. You said earlier that they need
all
4,000 of
that's
this
Kai'Sa,
gold
by the way.
Which is actually, I think, which is where you want it. As long as Kai'Sa can be the one to kill the Azir, you know, like, Ezreal's not going to outduel her. Rell doesn't have any damage. It's going to be all on Hecarim, who's building Chem Tank, and Gnar to kind of find these team fight wins. And this is what I was talking about earlier when I mentioned how NYU's draft is kind of two, they're kind of split on what they want to do.
Yeah.
Because it's very hard for Hecarim and Gnar to effectively stop Malphite and Olaf from running into Azir and Ezreal. And they were playing really, really well around getting man advantages and member advantages in the early game. But in these team fights, we're just seeing that the full-on dive comp is being able to execute.
And you said this about the chem tank. I liked it last game, but I don't know what you think about it this game, Zoc. I might have preferred to see something a little bit more like the Stride Breaker or something along those lines for the Hecarim.
Yeah, I mean, because NYU is just really threat-light. Really quickly here, the map is pitch black.
Yeah, NYU is really struggling on vision, sure.
Yeah, and they might be able to make use of it as Sylvan is going to go in onto Koroko. Not able to find a kill, but I mean, if Echo's running around your jungle and you're not doing, you can't do anything about it. In fact, we might even be looking for a dive top.
Yeah, Tramp here. Seriously, serious. That number. Yeah, they can wait it out. That's exactly what they're going to do, but he decides to get. Good idea. Really a bit of a missed Gnar ult there, and I don't know if that's going to get anything done.
What happened? Bot lane?
Yeah, Kakura's just still stunned.
Why is the ultimate
still
there?
Alive?
Azir ult whiff.
Interesting.
Oh, yeah, and they get that pick, they see that Azir's bot, and then they can just go ahead and start up the Baron here. Like we said, NYU doesn't have any vision to contest this, and they're just going to be able to take it.
Yeah, Kai'Sa does so much damage with the passive that they are maybe looking to contest. If you're a Max, Max is dead.
Fear Max is dead. Putting down some damage on the Olaf is pretty low as well as some other members. Jetchillin is Survivors taking him down, but again, just more people getting absolutely murdered here. Two kills going out of the rail. You don't really care about that gold, and now they managed to pick up the Baron. It will only be going on to three members here, but
they actually haven't done Baron yet.
They're kind of low, so
they might have successfully stopped Baron here at the expense of a couple of members, but it ends up being a 3-for-2 in favor of the Alini. But stopping Baron here for NYU might be worth it. I don't know, it's close. Aaron, thoughts? Do you think that's worth it for NYU? I don't know,
yeah.
It's a little awkward.
I mean, I think it's always worth it if you can stop the Baron. But it's sad to see. It's difficult to see NYU kind of put in a position where they have to be engaging to stop Baron when they, so essentially forcing Azir and Ezreal to participate in what Hecarim wants to do, which you know, they're never going to do as well. They're going to put themselves into a position where they're just going to get one shot. You saw in that last exchange that they jumped in to try and follow up with the Hecarim Rel engage and didn't do a whole lot. That was mostly off the back of Max and Believe kind of killing everyone. So they need to be forcing and constructing these fights around their Ezreal Azir and playing with the range if they want to win this. I think there it was fine. Stop the Baron, but they're on the back foot now for sure.
Well, and you said this in Champ Select, Doc, but the answer right now to the question of what is Ezreal even game is not very much. And
who'd be killing?
He doesn't have any damage, and you know, he can hit people with Qs, but like Olaf just is like, alright, I've got slightly more attack speed now. Like, it doesn't do enough damage to be meaningful, and it's going to be a second dragon here picked up. So Illinois now have recovered from what seemed to be a... they were on the back foot, and we mentioned how NYU looked really good on the rotations, but Illinois has recovered and has been doing a good job of rotating the places they need to be right now. As Kaisat 8-3-6 has three items and is definitely very scary, as they're just going to posture around Baron. And talked about, well, NYU doesn't want to be forcing into anything. They don't have a whole lot of a choice right now, and this is really scary for NYU.
Well, I'm going to double down on what I said, which is that I think team fights are completely winnable if you arrive to the objective first, you set up, and you get ready to disengage and peel when they get onto you. But when you need to go get onto this Baron,
it's tough.
It's real tough.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, barring a really, really perfect Shurima shuffle or something like that, I don't really know where this comes from, not to mention the fact that you're so damaged.
And even then, most of the champions on the side of University of Illinois don't care if they get Shurima shuffled. Most of them have ways of getting out of whatever position you're putting them in. And the way that this team comp works is they all want to be diving backline together anyway. So if they're staying as a group, splitting the team isn't really an option. I think it's really hard right now for NYU.
I think NYU really needs to find a way to cut off this Kaisa from the rest of the fight.
Yeah.
Either pick up the Kaisa or pick off everyone else and leave Kaisa alone in like a 1v3. But that's just such
she
a
might,
tall.
She might win it.
She might, not only might she win it, but it's also such a tall. Do it. Ikora will get a little bit of a turret compensation in the bot lane, but yeah.
Are you guys surprised by the lack of pulling the trigger on the Baron here? I feel like they're ahead enough that they can just start it.
I don't know.
I think you're right, but I think this is actually some of the nerves left over from the last game. They knew that they have overforced in the last couple of rounds, and I actually don't think that they are under a ton of pressure to start getting things rolling.
Kaisa 1v9s, right? Like, if you just stall for the rest of the game, Kaisa just kills everybody.
Right. Well, and like theoretically, like maybe you're scared about Azir scaling, kind of like in the last game where you had the threat of the Vayne. The difference between this game and last game is that instead of Lulu there to peel Vayne, you don't, and Galio, who are very good at, you know, countering dive, you know, you've got Ezreal and Rel, who aren't very good at setting up this hyper carry, making it so that the clock is not as present there for NYU as it was in
there. Yeah, a well thought out Galio ban, definitely meaningful here, although I don't know if they would have picked it anyway, as more posturing around the Baron, but nothing quite yet.
Delta, can you give us one of your famous item breakdown speedruns?
Well, I think really, the meaningful thing here is that we're seeing a lot of defensive items come through for NYU, and it's just hurting their damage input more. But I see the fight here.
Oh, damage is the name of the game. One member melted. Mystery Shrimp goes down. That is the second. This Kaisa is so big. There's so much damage. You see Olaf going into the backline. There is Fear of Max, tries to get some damage down here, and somehow...
Azir's still alive.
Yeah, Azir is still alive, but this Kaisa is also still alive here. Shurima shuffle does land, but Ezreal doesn't do anything.
Yeah, he's just like sitting back, helplessly pressing Qs, as that is going to be the fight that Illinois needed. They should be able to just get this Baron with Malphite and Kaisa alone, as there isn't any members that are able to contest this if you are NYU. They are going to... get the Echo TP through, so Anson by himself, he's just gonna die to the Echo here.
I'm confused.
And unfortunately for NYU, this is gonna be a hard fight to recover from. A really, really good unstoppable force if you are play for whatever his name is.
We're calling him
Malphite, and and it was a really good ultimate though from him.
And really good follow too.
Kaisa doing tons of damage. No doubt that while NYU might have issues with damage output, Illinois has no such problem.
Can we look at gold really quickly? Mr. Steve? Oh my god.
the Kaisa!
So it's a 7k gold lead?
And all 7 of it is on Kaisa.
Wait.
Literally. I'm not joking.
What? She is the six, only. Six and a half,
she is the only member other than.
Unreal.
And this is absolutely why Kaisa merits being first picked, because
or banned, exactly.
Not only is she so strong as an AD carry, dealing, you know, fights from dealing damage from the back line, but she works just as well as an assassin. And when you don't have the tools to deal with her, she can absolutely run over one of these games. 11 and 3 for Lee. Four items completed. They can't just. You've got to imagine that they're gonna try and
do something differently
in draft.
Excuse me. Ezreal has Muramata. Like, okay,
cool.
Like, all right, I guess. Gonna be third dragon here if you are the side of Illinois. And okay, we're looking at the attack speed of Ezreal.
I actually don't hate this pivot from Ezreal. Normally they
I don't think it's bad. It's just like you're so far behind. Like the damage still isn't there. I think the itemization's fine. I just think it's not enough right now.
Yeah, exactly.
This is a situation where I completely agree that Hecarim needs to be used.
Hecarim has Trinity Force here. I feel like this early game ends up a lot differently, but the siege is just going to come for Illinois. And right now, I mean, there isn't actually, like, other than the Azir, the issue is that you can only wave clear one lane with the Azir. Ezreal can't really wave clear that effectively.
Not into Baron minions.
Illinois can siege more than one lane, so this is going to be a really hard siege to defend. And Illinois right now is doing the right things, I think, to close out this game number two. And they're going to look now towards the mid tower. So far, actually, they're not quite splitting, so are able to defend NYU is a little bit. But yeah, rough here for NYU. Just not a lot left on the map.
So this is actually one of those moments where I think NYU can potentially look for something. They are pretty strong. If the team of University of Illinois tries to dive them underneath their turrets, and Ezreal and Azir can just be free hitting. Because at that point, Gnar and Hecarim can just kind of be bodies and block in those chokeholds between the turrets. So I think this is a part where University of Illinois could slip up and potentially throw the game, but it looks like they're not gonna do that just go to a bot lane.
They're being super patient, but the other thing is they've now lost Baron. They actually didn't end up getting any towers off of it. They didn't even get the top tower. This is gonna take a lot of damage though.
Yeah, Turnfear has to jump out and use the transform. The thing that I was going to note about your comment about the towers is, you know, get the value out of the towers while you have them, because, you know, that is a dying commodity in this game for the Lavender.
But maybe just a little too patient from Illinois, not quite pushing as hard as I think they could.
Yeah, I agree with that.
But also they don't get punished, right? Like, they can just keep doing what they're doing.
You do see, though, and I think this is important to note, that a lot of these fights have been kind of messy and near the jungle, where, you know, things aren't necessarily as front to back as they could be. NYU does have a pretty significant range advantage from their carries, and if they can stand back in a straight lane away from where Malphite could ult them, I do think that they have an advantage. And you actually saw in the bot lane there that once Azir stepped up, it was really difficult for University of Illinois to keep going with their push, because it's gotten to the point where they can't just ignore him. He's got three items completed. He's going for the death cap next. If he completes that, he's going to be doing tons of damage.
I mean, I was going to say, the thing is like, yes, Kaisa's a lot very ahead on items, but there becomes a point in this game where Kaisa has full build and Azir has full build, and that Kaisa becomes a little bit less like just a total stomp because the Azir is able to return so much damage. So that is an interesting thing to look out for. Obviously, there is some item, and the thing is, actually, we talked about how the gold lead is only on Kaisa. Like, Gnar and Malphite are even on gold. Hecarim is even on gold as Mystery Champ jumps in here.
Mystery Champ goes in, plus the stun and puts some damage down. That should be one member of
your
team. Block and Ari somehow still alive. I think Fear Max is tunnel visioning a little bit here.
Oh, no.
And he's not gonna. Sylvan follows up and ends up taking down, but on the other side, we see someone going down. Who is that? Oh, that is cut. The shutdown gets picked up. Believe here in the battle. Trying to put down some CC. Mystery Tramp here, full health, but he is under so much pressure from three members. The Echo almost on accident had to get away. He's 1v4. Oh! The Ezreal has arrived. That is the fight that they were looking for. Mystery Tramp putting down more damage on the mount fight. He's so close to being dead. And they didn't notice that there was a recall right under their nose.
They didn't notice there.
Oh boy.
Wow. So
and Baron is about to be up.
Oh, you want to talk about messy, Doc. I think that fits the bill. But it ends up being okay for NYU. And what I was saying is, yes, there is a big gold lead, but when it's all on Kaisaw, once Azir catches it, that almost becomes negated and it almost becomes even in gold again because all the other members of NYU are even in gold with their laners. And now that there's some extra gold on Hecarim, Hecarim is so much more effective than Olaf at this point in the game.
And they're just going to
almost argue that if they get this Baron, all of a sudden, I think Illinois might be on the back foot, but there's going to be a fight here.
It's so close. He wouldn't be able to steal it. No, Fury Max does secure it, and the Unstoppable Force is used to get out, as is the Ragnarok, and they're running away now. They are just going to head straight to the dragon here, and I think they have the advantage. Oh, this is so rough, right? You have to contest it. Of course, I mean, gold.
It is not soul point for NYU, I believe. So if University of Illinois wanted to give it, they could potentially. But they don't have any of their cooldowns. It looks like NYU is going to give it. They've gotten the Baron, and they don't want to overextend too much. Oh, actually, maybe I've been wrong. Azir's base TP'd. He's got a lot of items.
I think he finished the death cap on that back, actually.
Oh, boy. There goes the ensemble. And Son, and another member that I didn't see are gone. Believe Survivors is gone.
Oh! Huge!
But they're just so dead here. They do not have the HP or the damage to contend with this Kaisaw. A Baron plus a good fight is completely washed away for an Ace plus Cloud Soul.
Yeah, oh, and when Kaisa doesn't int, it looks like, and Malphite actually hits someone with his ultimate, things end up looking pretty good for University of Northern Illinois as Azir tried to do so much in that last fight, hitting a beautiful Shurima shuffle onto four, the Emperor's Divide connecting all across their team, but it is going to be the Ace. The Kaisa's too strong, and it looks like it will go to 1-1 in our series.
Yep, Illinois back there. Honestly, a bit more back and forth than I was expecting. There were a bunch of moments where we were like, hey, this is it. Closing it out there are the Eleni. We are headed to game three. Welcome back. I'm still Hotfish. This is still Delta, and we're still joined by Zoc, an absolute heater. My lungs are gone. And unfortunately, so is the hope of a sweep here for the Lavender.
Well, we got a series on our hands.
We really do. I mean, game one looked like a wash. They were just getting completely out-tempoed. And, you know, there were certainly some holes. Zoc, what needs to change?
Yeah, I think the biggest takeaway here is that NYU, I think, is playing out of their minds. I think their macro is really, really good, and they're setting themselves up for success in these games. I think they're being crippled by the draft. I think both games, the Hecarim first pick has... It hasn't been bad, but it's limited them going forward into the draft, and it has actually been punished. I think
hey,
we saw that
here's
as a punish.
Kaisaw. Hello, here, take Kaisaw.
Yeah.
Exactly.
I don't think you can do that.
Well, and not only is it a punish, but it allows University of Illinois to commit fully to a style of play that is normally able to be countered if you commit to it as early as they are. So I want to see something change in the draft to give them more flexibility to counter the dive strategy, which looks to be what University of Illinois is comfortable on. And I think if they can do that, they might be able to finish out this with a win.
Well, I mean, speaking of, you know, dive and really proactive, the Lavender are fans of that as well. They're quite good at playing these proactive strategies. So in my opinion, you've been offered the Kaisaw twice. The next time you are offered it, you are taking it, right? I mean, are we all in agreement about that? That if Kaisa is available, you're...
Yes, but do we know NYU gets blue side?
Well, I mean...
They get to choose, I think.
Okay, then fine. If they're on banning Kaisa.
Yeah. Right? I think you ban Kaisa on red side, but I think they get side selection here in this third game. So I do believe that they will be able to choose if they'd like to prioritize that Kaisa. Mm. And I think there's a chance that if they want to, they could do the same thing. They don't ban the Kaisa. And the Eleni go, oh, they're giving us Kaisaw again. And if they first pick it, they might be able to throw enough of a curveball to change up the draft in some interesting ways. But production, maybe you can let us know. Do we have... No, we don't. We don't have any time.
We are in draft right now, ladies and gentlemen. And NYU is once again on blue side. They had side selection, and they're going to run it back. We have the same. Oh, actually, no. We don't have the same band ones.
Once Karma again. Band this time.
Yeah, Karma Band out. And
thank God.
Not the Hecarim. Yeah. I'm okay with this. This is fine, right?
Yeah, it's better.
What do you think, Zach?
Yeah, I mean, I think Udyr is certainly on the tier list higher than Hecarim. He's kind of in that SZ tier. They're leaving Kai'Sa up again. And I don't know if that's the best thing to do after you just got completely 1v9'd by it early. I do think one thing about...
Why are they so scared of the Tristana? Like...
Well, so I think this is a Tristana mid. This champion has been played a lot in the mid lane and competitive recently. And I don't even know if it's that strong, but it doesn't seem like it really has any hard counters and is not punishable. It can kind of just kill everyone.
I feel like, though, like, I don't think let's say you pick Udyr here with Tristana up. I don't think that University of Illinois can go Kai'Sa Tristana on R1 and 2. And then Tristana, I actually think, is pretty good into Kai'Sa in that bot lane. So I almost wonder if there's an argument to, like, having that. Because now we have the same problem as last game. Well, what do we play into the Kai'Sa?
Well, you asked me about the Udyr pick earlier, and I think this is where it's good. Because the difference between Udyr and Hecarim is that when the entire enemy team jumps into you, Hecarim, it's kind of hard for him.
I literally said it right there.
Never mind. Right, I thought they were going to go to peel back, but they're just going to – they're both teams are going to try and just out-team fight the hell out of each other.
Okay.
You know what? I was
yeah.
About that. Say, but do you know what? I'm going to announce the picks and the bands, and then you're going to tell me what's
going on. Local play-by-play commentator out of his element.
Yeah, local play-by- on last brain cell that they all share between all of them.
I love this misfortune pick, by the way. I think that their mistake in the last draft was they let them pick Kai'Sa, and then they let them ban 280 carries before getting to pick theirs. And one of the ones they banned was MF. So, Aaron, I'd love to hear your thoughts, but I think that this MF Leona lane might be exactly what NYU needs to get this Kai'Sa out of her element.
Yeah, I do know that when the NYU bot lane is trying to kind of try hard and play sweaty, this is oftentimes what they go to. Jason, believe Survivors, is an absolute demon on the Leona. You can expect him to be all over the place, and I think they want to kill. I think they're sad about playing Ezreal last game, and sad about playing into Karma two games in a row, and they want to win.
Last week we saw on Leona, we saw Believe invade. So on blue side, invade the enemy red buff at level 3.
What is happening?
Wait, Mundo Jungle. This is the thing. We were talking about this last night with our good friend John about Mundo Jungle having some power against stuff like the Udyr. It's actually being played in LPL, believe it or not. And so this is a Mundo Jungle.
Like I said, all play-by-plays share one brain cell.
And it's not your turn.
It's not your turn. Do you know what? I have no idea what's going
on. Maokai is the answer.
The only thing that I was going to say is that last night we were talking about what we think the best supports are right now, and we kind of agreed that other than Seraphine,
Victor, too. Okay, interesting.
All right, I'm shutting up. You guys are
Aaron, talking what do you think about this?
Oh, my God.
There's a lot going on here. So, first of all, let's go to the Mundo. I like the Mundo here. You've picked Udyr, Leona, Misfortune. None of those champions late game will have enough damage to kill Dr. Mundo. I think Victor, it's really good. Well, Victor might, but Mundo also really likes building Magic Resist.
He built Spirit Visage anyway.
So right off the bat, I think there's a chance that Mundo can just kind of run over this game and never die. You've got the Garen there, which
is spicy.
Maybe is a comfort pick, but this is
Garen has Garen does have the highest solo queue win rate of any top laner, right?
yeah, sure, of course. I bet he does. But this game is just going to be a mosh pit, and I think NYU they've got kind of this advantage where they can get picks, but I mean, they might just, as much as I hate to say it, like, I don't like seeing Garen in competitive play, but Garen, like, they might not have enough damage to kill Garen and Mundo.
I am worried about, I think that MF Leona, they need to get ahead, and they need to get ahead from the jump, yes, right?
Oh, MF Leona, of course.
And I don't know, like, if MF has enough gold to effectively build, like, the Eclipse thing, which I don't know if it's better, but, like, if you're able to snowball this MF with, like, lethality and get some kills down and this and that, then I think it's really
powerful.
Well,
I mean, also, you know, if we're talking about lane, not a lot that's better than, you know.
I know I just said Mundo and Garen were going to 1v9 the game, but I do actually think that there is a lot of point and click melee crowd control on the side of NYU that is kind of a lot of the reason that you don't see these champions picked in competitive play a lot. That being said, NYU probably doesn't have a lot of practice against it. So in some ways, this is going to be kind of a test to see, you know, how good are these champions, even if they're going to be crowd control locked. And if NYU can just keep these guys locked down and away from this fortune, which I think they can. They've got Leona, they've got Maokai, they've got Udyr. It's going to be hard for them to get through those three people.
What do you guys think about picking a range top there instead of Maokai? Because you see the Garen.
Garen?
I don't play top lane. I mean, there's the possibility of going for a Kayle. Mundo isn't really a champion that can execute dives or ganks as early on in the game, so that could have been good. I am a little interested in, because the Maokai seemed like a pretty decisive pick. I'm wondering why they decided to go for that. Like you said, because you can pick kind of these ranged top laners and you're playing into a jungler that doesn't really gank as well. So I do think they could have abused that and gone for something that had more scaling. But I mean, Maokai is going to be tanky as hell all game, so still good.
Yeah, it'll be interesting. And I think it gives them a lot of flexibility with that ultimate.
So we're going to go to a quick break here while we have our 5 minutes.
We need to breathe.
Yeah, we need to breathe. This game is going to be heater. Stick around. Do not go anywhere for game 3 between the Lavender and the Fighting Illini. We'll see you all in just a moment.
Hello, everybody. We're back. I am introing because my play-by-play caster is not available because brain cell turn is not this. I can also hear myself, which is a lot, but here we are, game number three between NYU Woo! And Illinois University. We had a heater game number two, and I am really excited to see this one.
Well, if that one's a heater, this full furnace.
Yes.
Oh,
full
boy.
Furnace. All right.
Full All right. furnace. We've had a couple minute break here for those forgotten about what we are getting ourselves into. Zoc, give us a little bit of a...
Well, it's game three, and we've got a Garen.
And Mundo with Ghost.
And we've got Mundo with Ghost. I think I actually don't hate these picks, actually. I think NYU opted into their bot side, at least, doesn't really have a good way of killing Mundo. That being said, though, Uder will have infinite pressure in this early game onto him. So if they can get to, like, 30 minutes, Mundo might not die. But it's all going to be about Max, who has been playing phenomenally this series, just as a side note, and just seeing what he can do in these first couple of minutes and clears, as he will have pretty much complete priority, which is kind of the same, actually, for the other lanes. Victor does pretty well into Echo, much better than Azir did, which we saw in the previous game. He's able to get that shield. He actually does a surprising amount of damage with that siphon power and then the empowered auto attack doing a lot. And then Misfortune Leona speaks for itself. So I think NYU right. have a lot to work with here in the early game. And if they can execute even at a normal level, I think they can walk away with a win here pretty easily.
All right. Well, unless my co-casters have beef with this, I'm going to request that a lot of our camera be glued to this lane for the first little while. Because,
this is going to be the place we care about.
Yeah, this could get spicy real, real quick, whereas I think we have handshakes in it.
I'm also interested to see if this is going to be the Crown Victor or the Jensen Victor in the mid lane. So, it'd be interesting to see which one those is. I like Jensen a lot, but he should not pick Victor.
Jensen is a lot closer to being the.
That's a conversation for another time.
All right.
But
I was hoping at some point today we would have time to talk about the fact that for the first time in I think like 20 years, the Nuggets and the Knicks both have All Stars.
All right.
But there will be no time.
We'll
for that.
We'll move on for that
will,
for now.
There will be chit chat.
We're already seeing Udyr, his clear speed is a little bit faster than the Mundo. Not a ton, but is going to be able, especially on this Raptor camp, I think, takes up some time. We'll see what ends up happening here. So interesting to see where those junglers end up going. I do think that definitely, like Zoc said, the Udyr is going to have infinite pressure here in this early game, and it's going to need to utilize that effectively in order to help NYU win this game. But for the moment, they're just going to clear. Full clear is the standard these days, and it will be that for both junglers. And it looks like we might even get a bit of a fight here by the bot Scuttlecraft, but NYU does have priority for that if they want it. So that is good. And that is, you know, the first little maybe mini victory if NYU can find it. So Mundo's there first.
Yeah, he is just there first. I guess Udyr is more interested in Mundo.
So you can see the pings actually coming down from NYU here. Mundo doesn't do Scuttle Crab incredibly quickly. It does look like he'll be able to get it, but Just Chillin might be caught here. In fact, it's actually going to be a look onto the bot side as the crash down was already used. Udyr is going to walk in, but Max will not be able to get anything as we see pings coming in towards the top side for NYU, looking to get that second scuttle.
Commend the lane dominance that Mystery Shrimp has had this entire series.
Yeah, it's been insane.
Gross into three different matchups that I think are all not super straightforward for the champions he's been
on. Nope. Absolutely not. Well, I mean, also, he's out of lane.
Yeah, Mystery Shrimp has been killing it. Sure. All right. And also, what a great username.
Yeah. All right. Well, I was about to say something, but this is a. It's a little tense down here. I don't even know when to speak.
Yeah, I want to draw Udyr, attention.
Udyr does arrive in the top lane, drops down. They stun for just a second there, and Garen just.
Yeah, and you can see this is the power of the Udyr in the matchup with Malphite, or sorry, with Mundo. You saw that Mundo was able to be there actually, but because he doesn't clear incredibly healthily, even with the Fleet Footwork rune to give him that extra sustain, he was still 1 HP and couldn't do anything there. So
he just moves around the map so effectively.
Yeah, and he clears so healthily, and he's able to take camp so efficiently. He's even on CS, actually, but, you know, he's been in lanes, too, and exerting pressure, which you can't say the same for just chilling.
Yeah, and he does have a little bit of an XP lead, Fear Max does. However, he has not yet backed, so that'll probably even out or become close to evening out. But for the moment, the spot lane is just hanging out, Wakanari standing in that bush and pressing Q, as we are going to see the parallel convergence come through. As, ooh, flash for flash, and this might be first blood. Fear Max is going to get it, and that was a really well-played stun from the Udyr. First blood going the way of NYU.
Yeah. Bye.
Kikoro, my exploded watching that. That was incredible. That was
Kikoro is doing a really good job of holding the wave where it needs to be so that Sylvan has to be pushing aggressively to try and get something out of it. But there is going to be a TP play made in the bot lane, as it is four members from University of Illinois. But the counter will come through from Kikoro as Sylvan botches the tower dive. The teleport is canceled for Mystery Tramp, but it is a 1-0 for the side of NYU, and maybe even a solo kill. As
how is the lead survivors alive?
Yeah, I don't know. That guy is.
Sup, Div.
Yeah.
All right. Yeah, I mean, we look, you know, if this was a Counter-Strike stream, we'd be throwing some backs in the chat. That was, yeah. Oh, my lord. All right. I've been trying to find it for a while now. Friendly reminder. You know, no matter who loses this game, it is not the end of the tournament, I believe.
This is right. So we are in winner bracket, round of 32. And there is, of course, double elimination here in the CSL Star League. So not the end of the road, but, you know, winner's bracket's better than loser's bracket, as we all know. And right now, NYU off to a start here, up by about 1,000 gold. Kikoro making things happen, and obviously that great flash play from Fear of Max to get the first blood. Right before, actually, I think Echo was about 80% to level 6 when that happened. So really small window opportunity found there. So good job here, Fear of Max.
And getting the KP there onto the victor is incredibly important, especially in this matchup where whoever can get the push in the mid lane really can have the biggest impact. And the way that you do that on victor is by getting to that first evolution, which for those of you who don't know, gets significantly sped up when you get kills and assists. So the fact that he can get to that augmented death laser will mean that Echo will be under his turret for the whole game, and NYU will have even more priority than they've already had.
Well, and Echo wants to roam, you know, that's really a lot of where early to mid game is being able to pressure other lanes.
And now he just doesn't get
when wave is really hard. So good job from Kikoro understanding what he needs to do here to make this mid lane matchup work in his favor. Bot lane is a little bit ahead on the side of NYU, but not quite ahead enough that they can afford to engage directly into the rel, I don't think. It's 2v2.
I don't think so either. But I mean, given the fact that I think that, you know, MF is, I think, at parity kind of naturally advantage.
MF actually has bullet time though.
Oh.
So maybe there's a little bit of a window counter. But with the wave where it is, I don't think they're gonna find
Fear of Max right now just on the dragon. I mean, he just has Perma Prio in both of the lanes that are relevant.
Just for fun, can we get a stack check on the victor? He has he has the Death Victor.
Yeah, he just has it.
Okay. Alright.
Compared to when you had to buy upgrades, how much faster?
A lot.
That's it seems like it's a lot faster.
So right now it's a 1 per minion. You get 5 for a cannon, and then I believe you get 40 or 50 for each killer assist. So Kikoro is already halfway to his second one, I would imagine, versus 3,000 gold to get the fully completed perfect hex core. There is going to be the dragon coming up. Actually, it was just taken by NYU without even needing to rotate the bot lane.
Yeah, I mean, Udyr just walked up to it and took it. Oh, Kestrel taking so much damage, and I don't know if he wants to. Right back to the pictures, but times it poorly. But down in the bot lane, we have another fight going on. I believe survivors take damage, but the bullet time comes out, does a lot of damage on to Wakanari, but it's not good enough. Fear of Max going down the Udyr. Anson, no summer spells, no mana, and he will die in response. Oh, that's a bit really of a sad. Mess of a moment there.
Believe again, he's just always so aggressive, and he's gotten punished for it a few times, just taking enough damage there that he was effectively taken out of the fight before he was able to contribute to it. So some very meaningful gold going the way of Illinois, a kill onto the Kai'Sa, kill onto the Mundo, but Arel picking up kill as well. So not quite ideal there, but still a good fight for Illinois. Do lose Dragon for it, so not the end of the world for NYU. And it is about an 800 gold lead here for Illinois, so a little bit, but not too much.
Yeah, and we saw that even though Believe had been taken out, Fear of Max still wanted to go for it, using that blue smite even after their support had been taken down. But the bullet time just didn't connect onto the Kai'Sa, so unable to get any follow-up kills there. And, you know, Kai'Sa for the third game in a row coming out of lane looking pretty good.
Yeah. Well, I mean, you know, here's the thing. Here's what I can commend NYU. Even though these aggressive plays have not been their way, you have to make them with this
team.
Yeah, agreed. Right? You know, even if the dice don't, you know, fall the way that you want to a couple of times, whatever. Right?
Yeah, it's not the other one.
You don't have a choice. You need to play proactive here. Kestrel here.
I'm just having a bad time.
Yeah, Kestrel's just not really going to play the game. And, you know, we went over why, right?
Yep. You know, Death Laser.
6 minute Death Laser.
Yeah.
I mean, yeah, also, mad respect to a small indie company, Riot Games, for making an ability called Deathblade. I know that one.
I believe it's Death Ray on the, on the victory, but certainly the same sentiment. But yeah, this Echo is having such a hard time. You know, 20 CS down. The victor is just able to exert so much pressure in these setups, like you just saw there, kind of.
I still bought it.
Sticking a couple, and it looks like NYU is just going to give this Rift Herald here. They don't have their AD carry rotated up, which is a lot of their damage at this point.
I think giving it means that they end up gold. With an age, like, Believe Survivors is down, and so is Kakor. Blink of an eye, and that's a 2-0 with no real answer. Fear of Max flashing to try and get a kill. Will not end up getting it, taking so much damage from the Kai'Sa here. They cannot answer the Plasma Section.
Oh,
he's still alive! Fear of Max manages to get the kill.
Wait, he's insane.
What is happening? Still down in the bottom lane. Misfortune is just right clicking.
Yeah, beautifully.
Back here.
Was able to get one plating, so a little bit of gold for the MF, but definitely not the greatest thing in the world.
I think Anson could have gotten more there.
Maybe, but actually on the gold, if you look at the gold here before the Rift Herald was used, obviously that will contribute a little bit more. NYU actually doesn't end up losing any more gold than they were already down. The biggest issue though is this Kai'Sa, once again, 3-0-2, is starting to stretch out the gold lead, and
once again,
all of the gold that Illinois has, again, very scary. So I don't know. Listen to your casters when they say ban Kai'Sa.
I do wanna highlight though that crucially in this game, there isn't the same setup for Kai'Sa as there have been in the previous
ones. That's very true.
Last game we had the Malphite that could get that plasma onto people. Right now you've got Garen and Mundo are the people who are gonna be diving primarily, and I guess Rell, but Garen and Mundo, neither of them have ways of applying that plasma and giving her an in to use that killer instinct to jump into the back line. So I think there are going to be fewer options this game for this Kai'Sa to pop off than she
and neither of them have the peel available that we saw last game for that Maokai and that Udyr especially, so might be a little harder to stay alive in these team fights as well. I gotta admit, I feel like they could have just picked the Garen instead. I mean, the Malphite instead of this Garen in this game too, and been in a lot better position. But they did decide to go for this Garen pick, for better or perhaps for worse, we will see. As the Rift Herald will be dropped bot lane, which is a little interesting because it will not actually finish off that tower. We'll see if they have the pressure to do so. We see TP's coming in as well. Mr. Campus here. This is a 5v5 in the bot lane, and for the moment, oh, flash engage! Here comes Mr.
There comes the engage. He doesn't manage to get the ultimate. But Wakanari gets taken down. The bullet time does a lot of damage. Unfortunately, Mundo's just a little bit too tanky. Garen going into the back line here, putting the spin to win. The Death Ray trying to put down some damage back in response, but the Echo ult gets used to try and get away. Kai'Sa here.
Oh,
Lee going into it. So much damage. He's not quite able to get taken down by the victor, and that should just be the dragon there. 3 kills for naught.
Yeah.
Man.
So close, but just a little bit aggressive. Go ahead, Aaron.
Yeah, it was close for both sides. It did go the way of University of Illinois, mostly off the back of this Garen. I do want to highlight, though, that the Garen's effectiveness is kind of on a clock here. You saw towards the end of that fight how much damage Victor and Misfortune were able to get out just kiting back into Mundo and Garen, who kind of just have to walk at you. And
well,
so
what I was just gonna say is, you know, yeah, I mean, Mundo and Garen run it. Have, you know, Maokai ult.
Yeah.
You know, what's the play here?
Yeah.
They can just completely neutralize any engage from this incredibly short range team combo.
Yeah. Yeah, and so Garen at this point cannot be killed by Victor. Victor doesn't have enough damage. He's completed one item. He's got the Sorc shoes, which don't really do a lot against the tankier targets who have MR built up. But once we start to see him get to like 2-3 items, pick up the Lich Bane, maybe the Demonic Embrace, it might start to get hard for the Garen Mundo, but it might be hard for Maokai right now.
Ooh. Tramp just immediately goes down there, caught in 2v1. He was a little bit to get the turret. Can we look at top turret? Actually,
never mind.
Yeah, never mind.
Who cares about top turret?
Well, I'm just wondering. Okay.
Okay, he's close-ish. But yeah, a little bit awkward there for Mystery Tramp. Uncharacteristically out of position there. But won't be the end of the world. Not a lot to be done for Illinois here. They will get bot turret. Garen's going to get that one pretty cool.
That'll be first turret, actually.
And that will be first turret. So that is a little unfortunate. But again, you know, NYU down 4,000 gold now. So a little bit harder. And find, like we talked about in the pregame, they're going to have to find ways to get enough damage. And that is looking like a tall order at the moment.
Yeah, and especially in this bot lane, you've got a huge advantage over the side of Illinois. This MF has not been contributing to these team fights the way that you really kind of expect. And I think actually a lot of that is because there's the threat of this Garen just kind of running up and using the silence with that Q, as we might see here, the flash forward to the Stridebreaker. Enough to muster judgment. Takes him out.
Max is here trying to get something done, but the stun, the threat of the Rel stun will come in and try and Mystery Tramp, trying to get something done here. The Sapperling Ghost is not able to Garen down, and oh no.
Man, that's really unfortunate.
Yeah.
That was close.
That's tragic.
That Garen, XP-wise, is so big. Go ahead, Aaron.
You gotta watch out for the Garen. He's got the item completed, and this is why this champion's a medicine solo queue, because when you don't punish it with drafting the proper champions, it's really hard for him to be killed, as in the top lane, Kokoro might be in trouble here. The flash
is happening?
Is going to be forced out, and almost too quickly, I think, for the NYU team, this Mundo is already starting to be a huge problem.
Yeah, he is genuinely starting to go where he pleases.
Yeah, I was going to say, despite an incredibly well-placed turret and Victor Trap, Mundo still goes where he pleases. Max, you're trying to get a little bit aggressive there, but decides to think a little bit better of it and backs off.
Yeah, so item-wise, right now, actually, NYU is approaching being even with completed items. I actually lied, as Tidesuck just bought the rest of Phantom Dancer off of a single dagger, so I guess she was sitting on some gold. So never mind. Forget everything I just said. Tidesuck has a Phantom Dancer. And that is definitely a little awkward. Ocean Dragon, it will be Ocean Soul. This game is up in about 1 minute and 15 seconds, but that is a much harder contest for NYU than they would like, and I'm not really sure what they can do about that, if anything. So right now, the windows of opportunity, and Zoc, I'd like you to speak to this. What are those windows of opportunity for NYU if you're looking for things to do?
Yeah, so you've got, again, it's the Kai'Sa who's the real threat here. But you kind of got Garen and Mundo who maybe you can ignore them. Let's just say you can ignore them in a team fight. You do have a lot of crowd control available that is point and click that you could potentially lock down the Kai'Sa and blow her up. Other than that, you're really looking at this Victor here to be a lot of damage in these team fights. You know, hopefully you can get an MFR on top of that, but you know, she doesn't have a ton of attack damage at this point in the game. She's got the Kraken Slayer, maybe in 2 or 3 items, but you know, you're either hoping, I think, for a Wombo combo, or you're gonna want Kokoro to really, really step it up and have a great performance in one of these team fights, which you might see here.
A bit of a brawl going into the mid lane. The Slayer lands on just about nobody.
Oh.
I saw it. As is the rest of NYU lane, and they are gone. That is a 3-0 in the blink of an eye. And
no Max, Victor.
Max just has to recall. They can't do a tremendous.
So then my question for you, Aaron, is NYU even supposed to team fight? Like, but I don't know if they have a choice, but like, is there other things they can look for here?
I don't know, because they're playing Victor MF, and then they've got these tanks that are there to help them.
Look at that queue!
Which
what are we supposed to do?
It seems to be the story of the series. Kaisa is doing so much damage. Rel does go down. Looks like Fear of Max and Kokoro are on the offensive here. But Max, there's no flash available from this Victor, and he's just completely caught out. He will get killed here. Sloppy play from NYU, and
desperate.
We are desperate and sloppy, and we are looking at an 8K gold lead in this final game.
That is a level 13 Garen.
Yeah, NYU just kind of...
Why do I have to hear those words on a cast?
Yeah, why do we have to talk about Garen?
I don't like that. Zark, do you like hearing that?
I don't like it one bit, but he's got Stridebreaker, he's got level 13, and he's killed 4 people already, so we're going to have to deal with it here. The Baron's going over here to University of Illinois, and I mean, I guess they just can't draft around Garen? I don't know. I can't for the life of me understand why NYU doesn't want to pick Kaisa here. It would be good in this situation. It would be good in every other game they've played, and it's destroying them. I think just like in the last couple of games, there was a bad read on the draft, and the Mundo was picked, and there wasn't really a way to counter it. It felt like they just kind of didn't really adjust to what the enemy team was doing in their pick ban phase, and clearly they're being punished for it. So there's still a chance here that Victor can get 3 items and he can one-shot everyone and carry this game. But that is NYU's only hope right now, is Maokai's getting picked off again.
Trent here is in so much trouble. Has to use the Maokai. I was just trying to engage in that.
They might have a fight here.
Oh, they actually made Fear Max so close in. Sylvan being able to kite out. And this Mundo doesn't really take any damage. Actually, he's
no
so much
more flare.
Just by fight. Using the ultimate earlier to get away, ends up dying for it, and a really beautiful collapse here from University of Illinois.
And that's
spelling more doom for NYU.
This triple kill for Lee Gun Song. Excuse me, Lee Gun Young.
Can we look at gold here really fast? I want.
So they're up 12,500 gold.
For the first time, it's not all on Kaisa.
If Kaisa was up 12,500 gold, that would be very impressive.
Yeah.
But I do think that, unfortunately, there is very little left to analyze in this game. I don't know. I think this game is pretty much...
I think you can chalk this series up to University of Illinois having a better meta read than NYU. The Karma came out in the first 2 games, and I think it really overperformed and was a really smart pick. We saw NYU adjust to it in the 3rd game here with banning it, but it turns out the Kaisa by itself is just as good. They're going to try and make a play here onto Garen, but he's just going to turn it around and try and get a kill. They're using so many resources, the Ignite, the Solar Flare, but it's not enough. He just walks away.
Garen is so tanky, they just don't have the damage here for NYU. They're gonna try and flash, but the ultimate comes through. They might find the Echo, but at what cost?
Yeah, the cost is quite high. The shutdown does go on to Fortune, which is a bit of a boon, but...
All right, so they're down 12,000 gold instead of 13 now?
Yeah, good talk, right?
Like, okay.
You know, I mean, there's 2 inhibitor waves crashing right now, and, you know, inhibitor waves are scary, but they're a lot scarier with the people pushing them, you know,
just kill you on sight. Yeah. Guy
saw
8-0-7.
Yeah.
Lee Gun Young has been playing out of his mind in the series.
I wouldn't say an early favorite, but currently the strong favorite.
Yeah, and there just isn't really anything left. I mean, 13,000 gold here deficit, and if we have a misfortune, like, she doesn't get stronger here as, all right, Mr. Tramp's dead. Sure, why not?
Mr. Tramp is also getting stronger. He has Death Realm. 9-0-7. Unbelievable.
Yep, and they're just gonna push into the final inhibitor tower. They're gonna get the double wave here just for good measure. Victor, we see those lasers don't even tickle, and this is just a dominant game number 3 here, and we're gonna see the flash engage. Here comes the Garrett. He spins to win, and the knockup is here, just showing us here as well. Great Magna Storm, and that is going to be all the damage in the world. I guess Kaisa died, but it was at the cost of the rest of NYU. They've got 4 members. they've got the super minions and they have the series. This is going to be Illinois taking the series 2-1 over NYU in the round of 32.
Unfortunate stuff here. Lee will not get his perfect game, but Illinois will get the series mystery champ.
It was a perfect performance.
Yeah, it was an absolutely perfect performance. Lee waddling around in the Nexus. Unfortunate here for the side of NYU, but they're headed to losers. Back against the wall, time to get gritty. Time to put the chip on your shoulder. Yeah, it's a little bit rough.
Kind of a bummer. Especially I think that NYU on the day played better, especially in the first two games. I think their macro was a lot better. I think they put themselves in losing situations in the draft, and
they managed to play away from them in some cases. Well,
yeah,
thank you everybody. Welcome back to cameras here. Sorry, go ahead, Zach. Excuse me.
Oh, yeah. I mean, I think University of Illinois demonstrated that they can play this aggressive, divey, run-at-you style, team fight style very well. It seemed like when they were forced to do things outside of that throughout the series, they struggled a little bit. And those were the moments that NYU was able to exploit their weaknesses. I just wish that they could have came into these last few games with that game plan in mind to force NYU, or not NYU, to force University of Illinois off of their comfort strat and exploit that further. Because when you're letting them do what they want to do and you don't have the tools to do it from the champ select, it, of course you're going to lose. You're just setting yourself up to get beat. So,
I mean,
I don't know.
The power of that Kaisok twice.
Yeah.
And I think twice was one time too many.
Yeah,
I mean, three times was two times too many, and maybe three times too many.
Yeah, I mean, for a lot of game one, you know, from a pretty early point, we were confident NYU had control. But the moments where we were doubting it was because of Kaisok, right? That was the single hope in game one, and then you're getting dominated by this pick.
Yeah.
You've now given it over uncontested when you can float it and first pick it twice.
Right.
And then you do it again.
And not only do you, like, I think it's very generous of you guys to give them a game to adjust, but I think this champion has been first picked blue one in competitive or banned every game for the last like month. And if you're still not playing it, like, I don't know what's going on. I the Hakrim looked good and the Galio looked good, but at the end of the day, those champions right now are good because they can supplement Kaisa, and you know, maybe not all the time, but I don't know. I think at the end of the day, it came down to a meta read from Illinois.
I agree.
Yeah. I mean, you know, Kaisa is not, you know, she's not a hidden quantity, right? You know, people know the power of this champion. They know the power of her bottom lane. She's the number one priority pick in bottom lane in every region.
Pick in the game.
Yeah, period.
Outside of maybe Udyr.
Seraphine, maybe?
Maybe Seraphine.
Yeah, maybe Seraphine. It's just a little weird. But you know what? They still have a shot. Let's get some closing messages here, I believe. I lied. We have an interview with Mystery Tramp. By the way, really quickly, MVP of the series goes over to Lee. Three absolutely.
What do you think, Aaron?
Yeah. I mean, yeah, the MVP is who got to play Kaisa.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Funny how that works.
All right. We're going to get Mystery Tramp here in just a moment. Played an absolute beauty of a top lane game one.
Hello.
Hello.
What's going on, man? How does it feel?
Okay.
What a terrible question.
You gotta check it.
Was that reference to my name, the Mystery Tramp? Never mind, you don't get it.
I don't get it. I'm sorry.
Never mind, you don't get it.
That's the reference.
But you know, obviously, you know, rough series here. But you know, what are your thoughts? Maybe that's a better way.
Yeah, I guess to be specific, do you feel like, you know? I think it was really close two games, and I guess my first question, we talked about it, is what's the reason, I guess, that you decided to let Kaisa through a third time, even like what happened in the draft there that you felt like Kaisa wasn't something to prioritize?
Well, you know, I mean, maybe it doesn't make sense in hindsight because we did lose to it, but you know, hindsight, you know, still isn't 2020, but you know. Basically, our logic was that, you know, this guy's a Tristana one trick. We also found a Smurf, and on a Smurf, he's also a Tristana one trick. And yeah. And Nunu, the jungler is a Nunu abuser. He's a Nunu one trick.
Okay.
And our bot lane wanted to ban Karma. And in fact, this game, they said bot lane was a lot easier to lane against now that they banned Karma. It's just that one bot fight where the 3v3 went really bad.
So you felt like you just didn't have enough bans. Like, you needed to ban Nunu, you needed to ban Tristana, and you needed to ban Karma. So you just can't ban everything.
I don't think we concluded that we need to ban Kai'Sa. I think we concluded that what really went wrong was that bot fight. Like,
sure,
we stand by our decision of not pinning Kai'Sa.
Okay, fair enough. I mean, you know, I definitely respect that. Aaron, do you have a question?
Yeah, I just so if your takeaway from those games is, you know, that the Kai'Sa wasn't the problem, that, you know, that's your team. You guys do what you do for a reason. I'm just wondering, what do you think then went wrong, or what was the biggest problem over those last few games that caused you to kind of lose there?
Well, like I said, we really don't regret letting Kai'Sa through that much. It's just feeding Kai'Sa, you know, like, obviously, right. Kai'Sa's, you know, not going to carry the whole game if she gets no kills, but you know, it's, you gotta, sometime you just gotta not look at champs. Like, you just gotta look at what happens in the game.
I think that's fair. I think that's a fair attitude.
Well, I mean, what we noted in game, I mean, what we noted was that we thought there might be a bit of a, we thought there was a bit of a draft disadvantage for game one. And then, you know, 6 minutes in, we were like, all right, forget that. They're just playing, you know, 50 times better macro. It just doesn't matter.
Yeah.
And I'd also like to commend you. You know, I think that it's a sign of respect that you played the Gnar well enough in those first two games that they banned it in the third one. You were absolutely dominating on the Gnar pick. Maybe can you just talk a little bit? I have mixed feelings about Gnar in the meta, and I was wondering, is that something that you just personally feel comfortable on, or do you really think that it's just a power pick right now?
Well, it depends how good you are at Gnar, but I think Gnar is pretty strong. I actually jokingly said ban Tristana top because I watched EDG versus RNG this morning. Gnar versus Tristana, not a fun matchup.
Okay, you know, that's
very, very not fun matchup.
Sure, but you think the Gnar is just powerful in the meta, right?
Yeah, unless they're really good at Jace, or like they're really like a Quinn one trick, which no one plays Quinn unless they have it in their match history. Like, no one just pulls out a Quinn.
Okay, so, like, don't play Gnar into the Shy is what I'm hearing. That's what you don't want to, right?
And also ban Gnar versus the Shy, because Gnar has 100% ban rate versus the Shy.
Really? Oh, well, there you go. That's
well, after a certain point in the last few weeks.
Interesting.
Aaron, do you have anything else?
No, I guess I just want to say, like, I think you guys played really well around the top lane. And I think I just want to commend you for just the pressure that you were able to have without getting killed. I think a little bit of that was on the enemy jungler, but you were, for those first two games, just totally abusing that guy up there. So well done.
Yeah, let's not talk about the Maokai.
I guess I'll ask one more question, which is, you know, you don't get a break here. You play again tomorrow. And what do you think the one adjustment is, like, if you had to point to it? Is it just a couple of, like, small fight things that went wrong? Or do you think there's, like, a one thing you might want to change as a team for tomorrow?
I don't know. Hopefully we play better tomorrow.
Sure. Fair enough.
Well, so the last thing I'll say, this is a statement. It was a pleasure to watch you game one, because it seemed like every moment that we looked at the top lane, it's like, oh, Mystery's just smurfing again. It's just, this is the biggest top gap in the world. So congratulations on good play and a lot of good macro play all throughout. And good luck for tomorrow. We will be back casting your game tomorrow, and we're all pretty excited.
Yeah, should be good.
Yeah.
Thank you so much, and thanks for joining us for this interview. And we will see you tomorrow. Good luck.
Okay. Goodbye.
All right. That was Mystery Tramp top laner Lavender. We will, as I said, see them again tomorrow, 8 p.m. Eastern. It will be against either Rutgers or Renlet. I can't even say their name. Rensselaer Polytechnic Institute, which I'll be honest, I hadn't heard of until about a minute ago. But apparently, not only is there a school, they have one, but not two league. Not one, but two league teams.
What's the bet that their school is, you know,
100% league teams?
Yeah, that was my guess as well. All right, well, Aaron,
there's 10 of them, and they all play league.
That's exactly. Yes. All right, Aaron, any last words?
No, I mean, I think it was an exciting three games to watch. It was a bummer that it didn't go the way of the gamers in purple, but you know, that's how it goes sometimes.
Yeah. Well, I don't know. I mean, I think they were really close. I think that they the talent's there, the skill's there.
Oh, yeah.
I just need to clean up a couple things, maybe talk about the draft a little bit. But overall, I mean, I think that they still have a real shot. Double elimination means that
yeah,
even the strong teams lose. I mean, so far, my understanding of this bracket is of the top, so it's like a 128 team bracket or something ridiculous. Of the top 16 teams, 13 of them are now in losers. So it's tough. Like, it is a gauntlet out here, and you run the gauntlet. So all hope is not lost. We will see them again tomorrow. Zoc, thank you very much. Will we see you again tomorrow round?
I suppose so.
Sounds great. Hotfish, I know you're around because I will make you be around.
That's absolutely right. Yes. I mean, yeah, I mean, to the gamers in purple, like you said, this series, the way that I think about it, you know, the way that I look at the series, this is the kind of series where I think, man, you know, this is like a better night's sleep away from.
Sure.
In this strange kind of way, right? You know, better composure, being a little bit, you know, just a little bit less panicked, right? Especially what we saw in game three, things like that. So
Final words, Aaron?
Nope, it was a blast to be here today. It was fun to finally do the three-person cast as we've been talking about, and yep. I'm looking forward to the future.
Awesome. Well, I think that will do it for us.
Do your homework, follow us on Twitter.
Oh yeah, follow us on Twitter, and then do your homework in that order.
Yep. See you tomorrow at 3 p.m. Eastern for the next match. Have a good day, folks.
Thanks for watching.
Bye-bye.